Editor-in-Chief of Health Affairs. We're very pleased today to be discussing and releasing the April issue, Patients and Consumers' Use of Evidence. We thank the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, PCORI, for their support of the papers that are presented at the briefing today. As I noted, we have a full agenda because there is so much to discuss when it comes to the issue of patients and consumers' use of evidence. You all know, of course, that the Institute of Medicine includes patient-centeredness as part of the definition of quality in healthcare. And although everyone talks about the importance of engaging patients, it's a lot harder to do. And we want to make sure that this is not a topic that people are only giving lip service to. And we're thrilled to be able to draw attention to the issue with a series of papers in the April volume of Health Affairs. I would note at the outset that just as it's a challenge to get the patient's voice in clinical care, it's also a challenge to get the patient's voice in the peer-reviewed literature. And I just want to be honest, as a journal and at an event around patient-centered care and patients' use of evidence, we are presenting research findings, empirical papers, written, as our papers tend to be, by academic and institutional authors. You will see and hear the voices of many patients behind the stories of the papers and lots of questions about the appropriate and potential ways to engage patients in the topic. But at the end of the day, most papers in the peer-reviewed literature are written by people who may be patients in one aspect of their life, but are primarily health services researchers. So I just say that at the outset to remind us that the challenge of bringing the patient's voice in is not one where we point fingers at others and say you all should do a better job, but a reminder to all of us that we all need to do a better job. As I noted, the issue is supported by PCORI. Our theme advisor was Judith Hibbard at the University of Oregon, and we thank her for her guidance on the issue. I also want to make sure that you all know that in this issue, as in a few recent issues, we've included a new feature in the journal called the data graphic, where we attempt on one folio page, which is shown up here on the screen, to capture contents from a number of the papers and some external sources of information. So I hope that in addition to reading the many fine pieces of peer-reviewed work in the journal, you'll also take a look at the data graphic and give us feedback so we know if we should keep doing this, because it's a lot of work, but it's also a lot of fun. Without any more delay, I want to turn the podium over to Joe Selby, the executive director of PCORI. He's a family physician, a clinical epidemiologist, and health services researcher. He's got more than 35 years of experience in patient care research and administration. He came to PCORI from Kaiser Permanente, Northern California, where he was director of the Division of Research. It's my pleasure to introduce Joe Selby.
Thanks, Alan. Good morning, everyone. It's a wonderful turnout despite the traffic. Just want to say, first of all, how pleased and grateful PCORI is to Health Affairs, to Alan and the entire staff for a fabulous job. We, if you don't know how we do it, we go to a planning meeting and we write the check, and Health Affairs takes over, and it's a testament to how much high quality research there is in this area that we can have an entire peer-reviewed issue of papers that really hold together on the emerging science of how we actually get patients into the research process to generate evidence, and then how do we take that evidence into the clinical decision-making space and make it helpful to patients and clinicians as they make decisions. I thought this was just a fabulous series of papers. Clinical research, after all, is particularly the kind of clinical research we fund, has one purpose and one purpose only, and that's to generate evidence that decision makers, starting with patients, can use. It is not to lead to the next study at all. It's not to build a deeper understanding of mechanisms of disease. It's to change practice and help decision making. So the papers in this issue that are about how we actually get patients and caregivers involved in formulating the questions, planning the study, is a crucial beginning. The papers about how what happens when patients are involved, the papers about what patients are looking for in the way of evidence, the papers that show that it's not simply evidence, that there's other parts to shared decision making, all of these are most exciting. PCORI's mission, its mandate in the legislation, is both to generate useful evidence and to disseminate it. In fact, we're going to be held accountable for whether we changed practice, so you know that we're very concerned about how we actually do change decision-making and support decision-making. I want to be clear that PCORI, in all things related to dissemination, works very closely with the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality. One of the papers in this issue is actually funded by the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, and they play a central role per the legislation in disseminating not only what we fund, but disseminating patient-centered research in general. We have no doubt that patients can find a use for evidence. They manifest it frequently when the research addresses a question that is meaningful to them and when the results are clear and reliable. I think about the Women's Health Study and how within months of the publication of the main paper from the Women's Health Study, the use of postmenopausal estrogens just plummeted. And yes, that had a lot to do with the physicians, but it had an amazing amount to do with the women involved as well. I want to say that a lot of this is not actually comparative effectiveness research. It's the methods that we need to learn and develop in order to do meaningful comparative effectiveness research. And thus, many of the papers, five of the papers in this issue, were actually funded by PCORI, and they were funded by the methods program at PCORI. The last thing I want to say is simply that for those papers, my understanding that for those papers that PCORI funded, we have also funded open access. So those are readily downloadable from day one. And keep your eyes open for an announcement from PCORI in the not too distant future about open access for all of its publications. And the very last thing I want to say, and I think this is true, I have a habit of spreading things that I think are true. They ought to be true. I understand that the BMJ recently introduced into its methods section a requirement that researchers describe how they involve patients and other decision makers in the research process. That's a first. Okay, I'm going to turn it back to you, Alan, with a big thanks.
Thank you, Joe. I'm going to ask our first panel to come up. There's no break here. And just as they're coming to the front, let me explain the course of the day. It's somewhat arbitrary how we divide up the topics, but the first panel will talk about the importance of patient engagement. We'll turn to a second panel that focuses, that our papers focused on how we engage patients. We'll take a break. Discuss the role of patient narratives in decision-making, report cards in decision-making, and then a panel on price and quality, which are another dimension, of course, of patient and consumers' use of evidence. So as we get started, we're going to hear from Stephen Wolf, director of the Virginia Commonwealth University's, not yet, sorry. I do everyone first just to make it like this. Center on Society and Health, since it was established in 2007, also professor of family medicine population health at VCU. We'll hear from Millie Solomon, president and CEO of the Hastings Center and clinical professor of anesthesia at Harvard Medical School, where she also directs the school's fellowship in medical ethics. We'll hear from Kristen Carman, vice president of the American Institutes for Research, where she leads a team of more than 70 health services research professionals conducting research on a broad range of topics. Danielle Lavallee, a research assistant professor in the Division of General Surgery at the University of Washington. And Cindy Brock, who's a senior health policy researcher at the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, ARC, but is not here as a funder, but is here as the author of the Narrative Matters piece in this month's issue. So now, Steve, I'm happy to turn it over to you.
Thank you. Our instructions are to talk for only 5 to 7 minutes, so I apologize in advance for the speedy flight through the slides that I'm going to show you. But I want to begin by thanking Health Affairs for organizing this event. It's really a big contribution to the field, and specifically to PCORI, which along with other funders is really changing the culture of engagement of patients and other stakeholders in research. It's not something new in a sense. It's new for medicine, but the very, in general life, the notion of engaging stakeholders is not unfamiliar to us. Grassroots campaigns in communities have always known to involve stakeholders on the ground. Politicians know that they need to engage constituents. Any program requires engagement of leadership. But it's something that's newer to medical research. Not so much for the public health and social sciences field, which for many years have been involved with community-based participatory research, CBPR. So there's a long tradition in those fields of getting out in the field and engaging communities as partners in research. But again, in healthcare, there where there's more of a history of a more paternalistic history, it's been a bit of a shift. For some years now, we've experienced a movement toward patient-centered healthcare, patient-centered medicine. And that was a big revolution in recognizing that patients have a role to play in making choices about their care, controlling their health information, deciding which choices are best for them. But the movement that PCORI has stimulated and other groups like the BMJ and others exampled is to say, well, they need to be involved not only in their care, but also in the research that concerns their care. Patient engagement in research in the earlier years of my career often was a bit of a lip service of checking a box, putting a patient on an advisory committee, doing a focus group, and then you get to say that it's patient engagement. But that's changing. We're now moving to a world where the expectation from funders is authentic engagement. And it's not just engagement for the research. When you get stakeholders involved in research, you're committing yourself very often to not just publishing a paper, but getting something done. Because that's what the stakeholders want. They want action. They want outcomes. They want to see results. And if there's one message you take away from my talk, it's that the work PCORI is stimulating is getting things done. It's not only engaging stakeholders in the research, it's generating evidence that's improving outcomes. So I'm just going to take a few minutes, 4 minutes and 22 seconds to be specific, describe what I mean by authentic engagement and to give you a couple of examples from work that we've done at Virginia Commonwealth University. So authentic engagement is what we call the notion of involving stakeholders as full partners in all phases of research. And by all phases of research, I want to remind you that doing research involves a series of steps. So the very beginning step of figuring out what you're going to do research on, setting a research agenda and deciding the research question, we try very hard, and PCORI pushes this, to get the stakeholders on board at the beginning. To think through, well, what should we be doing studies about? What are the key questions that matter? Not what you scientists think is important, or you professors, but what we on the ground dealing with the real world think is important. And then the whole process of designing studies, designing what your outcome measures are going to be, and disseminating the research at the end should all involve the researcher and the community member and patient as full partners. And doing that is a lot about relationship building. Some of it's about science, but a lot of it is about building relationships. Trust, telling people who have typically been treated in a condescending manner that they are co-equal partners in the process is a trust hurdle to get over, and a lot of work goes into that. So the bottom line here is that placing communities and patients squarely in the center of research is central to what we do. The benefits of doing this are pretty obvious. First of all, it makes sure that our research is directed at questions that really matter, rather than something that might be the intellectual interest of an investigator. It makes sure that we design studies in ways that can actually capture the data that matters. Our work has shown that patient engagement helped us develop metrics that collected the right data that gets at the issues that matter to them. And importantly, patients know their lived world way better than professors and academics do. So they can bring a level of intelligence and insight to the subject matter that people who have not lived in that experience can't understand. And of course, getting them involved elicits buy-in. They can help with dissemination, they're full partners, they're engaged to carry the work forward. In the audience right now are one of our patient partners from our studies, one of the community residents I'll be telling you about, our program administrator, all of whom are representing a team of people that were very engaged because of that outreach effort. But most of all, the value of this is it elevates the moral plane of our research by engaging the people who are most directly affected by it. So first example I'll give you is in health services research. This is a tool that we developed with funding by PCORI to help patients make decisions about cancer screening. I'm not going to tell you about this tool or the results of the experiment. That was a 2-year study, and this experiment occurred in the second year. The important part of this story is the first year, that we devoted the entire first year to designing this tool. And we got serious about engagement. We drank the Kool-Aid and really went overboard with engagement. I know the print is small, but we formed we attend 2-hour focus groups involving 79 patients. We formed a patient working group with 46 patients. They then formed an online discussion board. They held 2 in-person meetings. They then formed an advisory board that met every Saturday for months and months throughout the course of the study. One of the members of the advisory board is in the audience. We did cognitive testing and usability testing. We engaged other stakeholders like practices, expert advisory panels. And what you can see at the bar chart at the bottom is that of all the comments that we received during this year-long process, the group that gave us the most comments were patients. Not the researchers, not the experts, but the patients. They had the most to say. The example 2, I'm down to 23 seconds, this is worrying, is our work in the East End of Richmond, inner city, African American, low income neighborhood, where early investment in building relationships with those residents as partners came about through the steps that are shown below that in this slide, but helped shape our research around health needs, assessments, and action plans that the residents developed. And so the diagram on the right is showing you a detailed action plan for dealing with mental health that the residents of this inner city neighborhood developed so that we continue to shape our research activities around their agenda, not ours. Last slide is just a montage of different products. So I make the point that this stuff works. It actually makes a difference. Showing you in the top left-hand corner a resident who's in the audience presenting research at Academy Health, a National Health Services research meeting, showing the results of residents doing qualitative research. It's showing media coverage. It's showing videos that we posted on YouTube about the relationship between education and health involving residents as spokespersons for how the process works. An informed neighbors core where residents of public housing have been involved with our research. A health impact assessment submitted to Congress in making decisions about SNAP eligibility that was shaped by our residents' engagement in the research. And finally, the picture at the bottom right-hand corner, our work in San Diego, not just in Richmond, where we involve community members in looking at big data for their county. And so what you see in that last picture are the community members sitting at desk workstations with computers that are allowing them to manipulate population health data for San Diego County to help make choices about how to move forward in improving population health. So I'll stop there in interest of time, but thank you for your attention.
Good morning. On behalf of my co-authors, Michael Gusmano and Karen Mashke from the Hastings Center, the three of us would like to thank PCORI, thank you, Joe, and Health Affairs, thank you, Alan, for having the wisdom to develop this themed issue. We did think it represented wisdom. Patient and public engagement is crucial. But our reflection was that many crucial themes like shared decision making or patient-centered care can seem so self-evident that we policymakers let ourselves off the hook, and we don't actually articulate some of the foundational reasons why we've put such great stock in those themes. So part of what our paper does is to do that. It addresses what are the fundamental reasons why we should encourage patient and public engagement. And actually, there we go. And the first part of the paper addresses, gives about 6 reasons, and it connects some of these very foundational principles and ethics to demonstrate that they undergird the reason why we should be focused on this. But we don't spend a lot of time on that in the paper, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it in my remarks right now, because the bulk of our analysis focuses on the reality that patient and public engagement should not be expected to be a panacea. It's not going to inexorably lead to better health care or better health policy, no matter how good we get at it. When you seriously try to achieve public and patient engagement with evidence, inevitably deep value conflicts emerge. Evidence alone is rarely definitive. Reasonable people will disagree about its importance or how to weight various aspects of the evidence. They find its source, there are differences of opinion about the credibility of the source. In other words, there's no escaping that value judgments have to be made about the worth of evidence. So our paper looks at the different kinds of values conflicts that you can expect to emerge when we take this concept seriously. And we look at those conflicts in five different areas: the clinic, healthcare systems, public health policy, the regulatory context, and the payer context. And we use a lot of different examples in each of those settings. But they sum up to, across those examples, they really sum up to three kinds of value conflicts. And I'm going to share those three. That's really how I'm going to focus the remaining time I have. And these are not perfect domains. They're blurry. They overlap. I don't mean to pretend that they're platonic ideals. They have overlap. But one way to think about this is that stakeholders can agree on underlying values, but they may differ in the weight that they assign to them. So an example would arise in, say, countries where there's global budgeting. There might be a question, for example, about how much to invest in rescuing the sickest versus investing in the healthy development of children. So in some ways, this is the easiest kind of dilemma. It's the classic kind of dilemma in bioethics because there are two competing goods. You'd want to rescue the vulnerable and you'd want to invest in children. But when faced with decisions about how to allocate resources, these come into conflict and different people would weight them differently. A second type of conflict, and this is very typical of moral tensions in the United States, where we aspire to a patient-centered ethic, which gives a lot of moral weight to personal choice. So given that those are our values, and we emphasize them here, we can guarantee that as we get better at patient engagement, we will also see more conflicts of this type between a patient-centered ethic that maximizes personal choice and an evidence-based ethic that protects community well-being. And I'll give you just two very obvious examples of this. Maximizing choice can, in some circumstances, mean reducing population health and community well-being. So here's one example. When parents refuse treatment of proven effectiveness, as in the refusal of vaccines, we are pitted between the value of wanting to allow for self-determination, that parents should have a great deal of discretion over the care of their children, and community well-being. And then the converse, there's also patients demanding ineffective treatments despite evidence. For example, when people request antibiotics for viral infections. So that's type two. The third type is when the medicines that are most controversial are not the effective or the ineffective, which you see on this slide, but actually much harder are when there are marginally beneficial but very expensive options. And stakeholders have very different views of risk, benefit, and cost. And the paper provides several examples. I'll just mention one is, you know, the concern when we have very expensive chemotherapeutic drugs that may extend life for 5 months, but the terminal illness will still be a part of the picture. Patients might want that, but health systems and payers might question it, and that is increasingly being questioned. Another example would be the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force mammography guidelines, where I probably don't have time to tell the whole story here, but just to say most people in the room remember that their recommendations were very controversial regarding the need for screening in women 40 to 49. They didn't conclude that mammography screening offered no benefit. It's in this marginal benefit category. Instead, the task force invoked the fact, that screening in this age group would result in a large number of false positives, and they considered that an important harm. So they put a lot of weight on that. Of course, cost was also there, but wasn't discussed as overtly as it might have been. So for each of these value conflicts that we described, the paper offers our views about how these conflicts should be managed. And we also offer some cross-cutting recommendations for how to bring patients and the public more directly engaged with the value questions as well as the evidence questions. We offer our views, but we recognize that others may disagree. We're just trying to provoke conversation. I would say our primary goal was to illustrate the reality that evidence alone cannot help us determine right action. We need patient and public engagement with evidence combined with patient and public opportunities to discuss values and value conflicts that are almost always at play. Thanks.
Nice job. Oh, fantastic. Well, I could not have asked for a better introduction to my talk. I feel like sort of half of the context was just placed, so thank you very much. It's just fabulous. I am delighted to be here today and really truly in the company of so many folks who have really advanced understanding of patient and consumer engagement and using evidence. I do want to give a shout out to a couple of now PCORI employees, Jean Slutsky and Joanna Siegel, who are really incredibly instrumental in the work that I'm about to discuss here. And I think Jean was actually sort of the brainchild of this project. So what I'm going to talk to you today about is this project, but I want to take a little step back for just a moment. 3 years ago, I think actually on the same stage, I shared a framework about patient and family engagement that really illustrated how patients, families, and professionals can work together in active partnership to redesign healthcare, right? And I outlined a movement really from simply consulting patients to involvement and shared leadership. And it really highlighted that engagement is not just about individual behavior change, but it's about patient and family participation in decision making, point of care, in healthcare organizations, in research, which Corey has done such amazing work on, and in policy making. And just as we have found that partnerships between health professionals and patients can really make a difference for better outcomes in individual care, partnerships between policymakers and citizens, we think, can help guide decisions really on complicated policy questions and get us to better outcomes. And public deliberation is a key and, we think, underused mechanism to get us there. And what's interesting, the talk you just heard, think of this as the mechanism to really get at some of these value-based conflicts. So what is public deliberation? Oh, where am I pointing this to? Oh, there we go, sorry. So public deliberation is a consultation approach, and the object here is to obtain informed input and meaningful insights regarding how people think about key topics. So you might think of this as similar to a focus group in that you're getting information from a group of people, but it's really quite different. Deliberation is designed to get informed input rather than sort of intuitive top-of-mind reactions or the prevalence of opinions you might get in a public opinion survey. And it really has four core elements. You bring people to convene, either in person or remotely. People are educated on the relevant issues, and that can be with materials, that can be with experts advising them and interacting with them. The key point is it requires balance, and it ensures that all sides of an issue are explored and discussed. Participants are asked to discuss complicated values-laden issues that cannot be resolved with technical information alone, which is just what you are hearing about where we're at in many of these issues. And then elements of these dialogues are reported and also oftentimes recorded to the sponsors to include in decision-making and sometimes to even come up with the actual crafting of solutions themselves. So what was this work? Well, we had a demonstration project, 3.5-year randomized control study that included 76 deliberative groups in 4 cities with 907 participants between August and November of 2012. That was a lot of people and a lot of deliberative groups. So the goal of the project was first to expand the evidence base about deliberation, right? We looked at multiple deliberation methods. We've previously studied work that shows we can effectively elicit input from a diverse population of individuals on highly complex topics. We also wanted to get input in a particular topic of interest to ARC. One of the things we're talking about today is participants' views of evidence and how it should be used in healthcare decision making. There's a broader portfolio of finding. But we posed the following questions to all participants. Should individual patients and/or their doctors be able to make any health decisions no matter what the evidence of medical effectiveness shows, or should society ever specify some boundaries to these decisions? Now, to help participants grapple with what is an obviously complex and abstract question, we created a number of case studies on particular health topics to help them work through these issues. So what did we learn? Well, guess what? Good news, participants think evidence is extremely valuable and important in making healthcare decisions. But participants emphasize that what works for most people may not apply to individuals or to them in particular, saying, of course, everybody is different and therefore application can vary. Participants also described uncertain evidence as being more than just mixed research results or unclear evidence. They perceived uncertainty as arising from applying population-based studies to them. So thus, given the perceived sort of limitations of evidence derived from population studies, evidence might not be as important as other considerations, such as patients' personal preferences, convenience, doctors' clinical judgments, or even concerns about out-of-pocket expenses. They also expected clinicians to be aware of, follow, and understand medical evidence, and especially guidelines from medical societies. But they also believe clinicians are experts. They have their own independent expert evidence, and they're experts in them, and therefore clinicians should be able to deviate from those whenever individual causes or needs necessitated. Now, all's not bleak, sort of, for proponents of evidence, however. Evidence of physical harm, either to individuals or to the community, was the most persuasive factor in increasing participants' acceptance of limits on patient choice and physician autonomy, and limits were acceptable under those conditions. Given this, participants really called for more education and transparency about evidence to help inform decisions. They feel we need much more aggressive efforts to get this to them. They do not have access to what they need, and they very much want this to be a high priority for governmental agencies to bring this information to them so they can make these decisions. So what are the really key takeaways or implications of this work? Well, most importantly, kind of given our last conversation, when given the opportunity to learn about and discuss medical evidence, participants' views shifted, giving more weight to medical evidence and less to patient preferences in a couple of key areas. So when people understood the serious threat to both individuals and the larger community from overuse and misuse of antibiotics and resistance that would develop, they were much more willing to accept limits on patient and physician autonomy to decide. And it was kind of amazing in these groups. It was a light bulb epiphany moment for a lot of people. And I can't tell you the number of deliberations where people said, I did not understand that my choices were having this impact. I think very differently about this now. The other good piece of news is that the public strongly supports effort to translate medical evidence and make it accessible to patients. We also don't know that people view clinicians as arbiters of evidence, and that means our system is going to have to create the room and the space for clinicians and patients to talk about evidence, because that's who is the final arbiter for them, and they need to be able to have that time with them. Another key takeaway is evidence of harm resonated much more so than evidence of effectiveness with our populations. So stressing this impact is really important in communication, but of course, as we're learning with PCORI, in order to communicate it, it has to be in the evidence, which means it's got to get into the studies, the endpoints and the concerns of consumers and patients and families, if you want them to use the information, must be embedded in the research studies. Otherwise, they can't really use it and they won't find it relevant. And finally, in an era where we are talking about changes in resources, we're innovating all over the place, we're altering delivery mechanisms, we're altering payment mechanisms, patients, families, consumers must have a seat at the table. As we conclude in the article, arguably a high quality, efficient, and sustainable healthcare system in a world of more finite resources is going to remain out of reach without thoughtful input from consumers. And given how much responsibility and accountability they have for the outcomes and how much they're paying now, I think it's truly folly not to give him a more genuine seat at the table in decision-making. Thank you.
Good morning. It really is exciting to be part of today's discussion and to be able to present the work on behalf of my colleagues and collaborators on this project. The impetus for this project came from conversations I was having with my co-authors about our respective experiences capturing pain and function outcomes following spine and total joint replacement surgeries as part of quality improvement initiatives. And what we saw was that there was this changing environment, much of what Kristen just ended on, that policymakers are pushing for patients to have access to their electronic health record data in ways that inform their decision making. Payers are expecting patient-reported outcomes on pain, function, quality of life as part of the treatments they're receiving. And patients continue to innovate and challenge how we think about healthcare. One great example of that are the communities that are coming together to share data, to collect and share data, to inform not only their health, but the health of others. But given that these convergence of factors are coming together to support patient-reported outcomes in clinical practice, there's still questions remain about if our health systems are ready to integrate the patient's voice in a way that's meaningful to transform care. So that led to a year-long project where we sought to learn from people in the field who are directly applying patient-reported outcomes as part of clinical decision-making. And what was interesting is through all of the folks that we talked to and the examples that we looked at, one theme emerged, and that was the value that patient-reported outcomes provide in really engaging patients and their healthcare teams in discussions around healthcare. So with my remaining time, I'm going to talk about the value that patient-reported outcomes have in patient engagement with healthcare, talk about some of the barriers that we see, and conclude with a few recommendations for next steps. So patient-reported outcomes provide a unique lens on an individual's health, different than what we can see through lab tests or clinical assessments. As as chronic conditions progress and we start to see patients coming in on a more regular basis, they're really the best source of information about how their symptoms are changing, how their function is changing, how their mental health might be changing, to help inform the types of decisions that should be made with respect to their care. Patient-reported outcomes also help us track the impact of treatments or changes in lifestyle. One great example of this is the orchestra tool that was developed for children with inflammatory bowel disorders, as an example. The way this tool is set up is it allows patients and clinicians to come together and select a set measures that they can track so as changes to lifestyle, sleep, or diet are made, or planned changes in medical care occur, they can follow these measures over time and help understand how those changes are impacting their care. It also helps prioritize discussions for office visits. Patient-reported outcomes can also inform treatment decisions. One example of this is in orthopedics. The capture of pain and function over time can help people understand when is the right time for the next level of care. So for example, if pain isn't changing with the onset of new medical treatments or physical therapy, or pain starts to occur overnight while someone is sleeping, that helps inform whether the timing for surgery is upon the patient. Patient-reported outcomes also provide an opportunity to monitor health and well-being as part of well-care visits. Depression screening, a CMS quality measure, is frequently captured using the patient health questionnaire. This is probably the one patient-reported outcome that's most commonly implemented in healthcare systems. In some organizations, group health is one example, is actually collecting and reporting this information back to patients through their electronic health record. And finally, the newest way to the table is connecting patients and providers through patient-generated health data. I suspect there might be one or two people in this room that have a Fitbit on their wrist or have an iPhone in their pocket. Those devices are now allowing people to capture information about their sleep, their diet, their exercise, other aspects about their health, to share that not only with their clinicians, but also to learn themselves about how their health is changing. So despite the support for the use of patient-reported outcomes, challenges do exist that hamper the ability for widespread and scalability. Workflow is probably the biggest challenge that we hear. How do you integrate the capture and reporting of patient-reported outcomes in a clinical setting where that time is already considered to be quite compressed for providing patient care? Measurement is also a key issue. Patient-reported outcomes are probably best understood in the research setting. As we move those now to the clinical setting, concerns exist about how do we select the right measures that really are going to inform direct patient care, individual patient care, and how do we collect those at a time that really is relevant to clinical practice? Most importantly, as these tools help generate areas of concern for a patient, how do we make sure that those actually lead to actionable changes? So a score may highlight that someone has a problem in a certain area, but there may not be a linkage to how you best provide care to that individual. Electronic health records are improving in their capabilities of capturing patient-reported outcomes, but it's not complete. There are also challenges in terms of how that information is reported in visual manners that can support clinician and patient decision making. Further, the lack of interoperability between systems is a challenge, and it keeps that information sometimes siloed in one system but not easily shareable. And then design. We've heard a lot about patient engagement. I think in terms of the design for workflow processes and how this information is captured, more focus needs to be placed on how users of these systems, users of this evidence, are integrated into those systems. So I'm going to conclude with some areas of future focus that we think are important. The first is partnerships with patients. As we work to incorporate patient-reported outcomes into clinical practice, patients need to be part of that team to understand how it impacts their care, that the patient-reported measures don't, that they add value to the visit, they don't detract from it. They can also help us think through workflow issues. How do we make this more efficient? How do we engage them in the discussions about why this information is important and how it can help inform decisions? And finally, research. There's some really great research that's currently funded that's exploring how you translate patient report outcomes to actionable data. We hope that continues. And focusing on new data, patient-generated health data, how do these different mobile devices impact the care that patients are receiving? Are they effective ways of improving health? And how do we then take this information, or should we take this information and integrate it into existing health systems? So I'll conclude there. I appreciate the time and look forward to questions later.
Good morning. As Alan alluded to, I am here not as an ARC researcher, but as a daughter. My story is about being the healthcare proxy for my father when he had surgery for complications of prostate cancer. The surgery went very well, and afterwards he was trying to empty his bladder, and he started searching for words, couldn't find words that he was looking for. They called the stroke team, half a dozen neurology residents assessed him and started wheeling him out of the room. "Where are you going?" I asked. They told me that they were going to take him down to the ER to give him TPA. Now, TPA is a medicine that breaks down blood clots. I said, "I haven't consented." And their response was, "This is an emergency." Well, I was in the middle of an ARC project to improve informed consent in hospitals. And those who know me are laughing particularly loudly because they know that I was just not going to stand for that. And so I said, "I am his healthcare proxy, and you are not giving him anything without my consent." And they conceded and invited me to walk with them. And as we trotted down the hallway, they said, and they repeated over and over and over for the next hour, that he'd had a stroke, he needed this medicine, it would dissolve the clot, and there was a very short time window in which they had to deliver the medicine, and so please, would I consent? That was not enough information for me, and I did not consent. And I could not get the information. I called my mother, and she said, "You know, it may just be the good press coverage that TPA has gotten, but she wanted my dad to get the medicine." So just within the 3-hour treatment window, he got TPA. As he was being wheeled up to the neurology unit, He had a seizure and a second seizure. He had had an extensive bleed into the right side of his brain. And that night, he shook uncontrollably. He didn't appear to understand us. He couldn't talk. And I was told that he might never talk again. And I second-guessed myself. I said, you know, should I have consented right away? Should I have not let them give the medicine at all? And I was so frustrated that here I was an expert in health literacy, and I couldn't get the information that I needed to make an informed decision. Since then, I've had some time to think about how the residents could have done a better job communicating with me. And the first thing is that they should have listened to me. They should have, if they had, they would have learned that I was not convinced that my father had had a stroke. And if they had done that, they might have been able to tell me better what the results were of their assessment. The second thing is that they didn't ask me anything about what I knew about my father. So doctors are experts in medicine. I am not a clinician. But we have the expertise about us. And those residents didn't know that he had been wobbly on his feet that morning, that he hadn't been eating, and then when he ate, he threw up his lunch. They didn't know that I had seen something like this when he'd had a bladder infection, that, you know, there were other things that were going on that they didn't know about. They also didn't act as if there was a choice. And they needed to talk about what might have happened if we didn't give him the medicine. What were the likelihood of the different possibilities from that? And as the speakers mentioned earlier, you know, they had a rule of thumb based on a clinical trial that wasn't about my 88-year-old dad who just had surgery. They needed to personalize the medicine for me. And they needed to check that I understood after doing that, because I'll tell you, my normally high health literacy was nowhere to be found at that moment. I think that that condition has been created because there is this frenzy to deliver the medicine quickly, that you know, their whole campaigns to try and reduce door-to-needle time, and they have a protocol that they follow, and they think that they don't have time for engagement. And they're wrong. There was time while they were doing the assessment. One of those half dozen residents could have been talking to me about the potential decision that I faced, asking me if there were any other family members that we needed to consult. They also did a CT scan to make sure that he wasn't already bleeding in his brain, which is a counterindication for the medicine. And during that, somebody could have gone over the results. Maybe they could have even used a personalized, unbiased decision aid to help me understand the evidence and apply it to my dad. And frankly, they used evidence as a cudgel to coerce me into giving consent, and that is not acceptable. Now, my article isn't about sour grapes because my father had a brain bleed. There are going to be bad outcomes no matter what, but how patients and families feel about those outcomes matter. You know, some people will feel, well, you know, at least we tried everything to give him a full recovery. I want to take that risk. And other people will feel terrible that something that they did resulted in a loved one being hurt or dying. So they need to attend to what we need to make an informed choice. And what I needed at that time was an unbiased interpreter of the evidence. I needed somebody to tell me that there was a choice, that it was a hard decision, that there were no guarantees, and ultimately it was our choice, because after all, patients and families are the ones who are going to live with the consequences. Thank you.
I'm inclined to close the panel right there because I'm not sure we can end on a more pointed note. You all went equally over your time, so we have an equally limited amount of time for Q&A. Rather than go straight down the line, I just want to frame a couple of quick questions. We're not going to have a lot of time to bring the audience in, but each of you in your own ways were looking at various parts of the system. And I just wonder if those of you who would want to weigh in could reflect on what you view as the most significant barrier, either in the research endeavor or in the clinical setting, from the system side for authentic patient engagement. So not the barriers on the patient side, but what are the system barriers? Danielle, you sort of came the closest to answering that most directly. But I just think, you know, for those who are speaking to this large, complex healthcare system and health services research endeavor, what's the biggest barrier to overcome? Cindy.
Yeah, sometimes I hearken back to the days of the first Clinton campaign where they said it's the economy, stupid. Because it is the system, stupid. You know, there aren't any evil practitioners out there, but that we have to build in to our protocols, to our systems. So, for example, their protocol looked like evaluate the patient, get the CAT scan, give the medicine, and into that, they have to build evaluate the patient and explain what we're doing and what the decision might be, and do the CAT scan and engage the family, and you know, so that as a system, that engagement is hardwired.
So I would just add, I think with respect to patient-reported outcomes, two trains left the track at the same time. There's this expectation that we capture patient-reported outcomes, but there's also this need to learn about how to apply them to really change patient care. And I think that co-learning process is going to be challenging, but it also opens an opportunity to better support engagement at healthcare systems or hospital levels, engaging with patient and family-centered care, their patient and family advisory councils. Is going to be really critical to making those changes effective.
So I'll add, and I guess it is a sort of a big picture response because I think Cindy has it just right. It's the system. Engagement is not just what individuals do. It's what the system does to support and make it possible, whether we're talking in individual care, in organizations, research, or policy making. And that means it has to be, yes, we have to prepare patients, but we have to prepare clinicians for the engagement. We have to create a system where the routines of the system make it possible, probable, not improbable. And then we have to surround that with the things both parties and sides needs: transparency, information, and measures. There are details. In fact, we created a roadmap to discuss some of these things, but I do think the big picture is to think about it as systematically as we do quality improvement, right? And to apply our same knowledge base to making this happen.
I very much agree with what's been said before, that there's a very interesting book by Sharon Kaufman, an anthropologist who's observed care in health systems, and she points out that we have an ethic of shared decision-making and informed consent, but when you look closely at practice, people are more like yielding to protocolized pathways than they are actually making informed decisions. And her use of the word yield to really resonated with me. And if I may add a second point, I think, and maybe even more foundational, is I think one of the biggest barriers is that we have not yet in this country accepted, we don't have social norm, we haven't legitimized the need to think about cost and quality in our decision making. And we don't have any national entity that is setting those kinds of parameters the way they do in other countries. So it's falling to the system level, and I think some systems really are stepping up as they become learning health systems to begin collecting cost and quality data, but they're going to absolutely need to engage their community because these are going to be conflictual. So I think that's a huge barrier, but something we absolutely have to wrestle with.
I would just briefly add, I agree with all of the prior comments from my fellow panelists. There's a series of steps and details that need to be worked out to transform the system to provide greater input for patients. But at the root of it all, the biggest barrier, in my view, is political will to actually make those changes. And I think, I don't mean political in the sense of politicians, I think political in the sense of physicians and the healthcare community needing to get a bit of humility that may be lacking at this point. And I say that as a physician. What I think gets in the way of making a lot of these transformations is realizing that the old-fashioned belief that patients don't know enough, they haven't gone to medical school, they don't know enough to make these decisions, if we're talking about clinical care, or for researchers to say, lay people cannot understand research and cannot make a meaningful contribution. Getting past those old stereotypes and educating leading researchers and healthcare practitioners that patients not only are experts in themselves, as was pointed out in the last presentation, but have a huge contribution to make to research, potentially can transform research from being ineffective to impactful, and that there is a moral obligation, both in patient care and in research, to shape the work around the needs of those who are affected, is an important transformational barrier to get over to then motivate people to make these other changes.
So let me just ask one more question before we take a couple from the audience. I'm struck by how resource intensive many of the interventions you all describe are. This is more time, this is more community meetings, more evenings, more weekends. Well, everyone's talking about how we already have too many resources in the healthcare system. We can't afford to put the number of resources we have there. My question is sort of, where do we go from here? Is this that we're at a learning phase, and as we scale up, the number of resources will go down because we become more efficient at this? Or is this just a cost that we're going to have to bear in terms of dollars and time? I just wonder how we really diffuse this if everyone has to do what you all describe when they're not used to doing that. Who wants to tackle the resource issue?
I guess I'll take a start. You know, it's interesting to me. There are an astonishing amount of resources in healthcare, as we all know, going to lots of different things. I think one could make the argument, and we have certainly, that if you employ a number of strategies at the system level and the individual level, that in fact the goal of these strategies and the eventual outcome is going to be a system that achieves the triple aim. Because a lot of things that are happening, you're doing right now without patient input and the people who sort of sit at the center. So you want greater patient safety. Patients are probably going to be able to help you figure that out. It might seem like a time suck, but the reality of it is, in the end, you're going to get to the outcomes you're trying to get to. Getting patients and clinicians to talk about evidence doesn't mean physicians have to spend an extra 20 minutes. It might be as simple as when someone calls for the appointment, the person reminds them, are you bringing your list of questions? Are you bringing the list of things we care about? We always end up feeling about these things that we're asking for too much of people. But if we bring our system caps to this and we think about how do we build it into the normal workflow. If you had patient-reported outcomes and patient digitized it before they went into the office, physicians would have that information. That conversation would be a heck of a lot more efficient and highly productive. So I really argue this is about how we're framing the issue, not about that it actually is going to take all that many more resources.
Sydney.
Yeah. I would also add, in my response to the last question, I sort of was echoing Kristen there in terms of when you build it in, it just becomes part of how you do business. But I would also add that when you give patients some autonomy to make decisions, they're not always going to opt for the biggest, best, and most expensive thing. So TPA, the example I talked about, is a very expensive drug. And some people are going to decide actually that that does not fit what they want. And we don't talk about, well, okay, we've now saved money for that. And that's the point is not particularly to save money in terms of helping patients and families participate in that decision, but it's not necessarily the zero-sum game of if we take the time to engage them that we're somehow upping the whole cost of the healthcare system.
And to build on that point, if you think about it, it's a fascinating question to say we don't have the resources to make sure that the healthcare we're delivering is actually what patients want. If we don't have the resources for that, we need to take them from something else. And studies have shown that when you do, as Kristen talked about, educate patients about the benefits and harms of choices, they often don't appreciate the magnitude of the harms and ultimately decide, you know what, I don't want that fancy expensive test because I don't want those potential harms. But whether they choose to or not, and whether it increased costs or not, it's what they want. So how can we argue that it's too much work to find out and we should just go ahead and administer the treatment that we think should be given? A quick anecdote I want to share on the research side. When we submitted our grant to PCORI to do the study I talked about, what we proposed doing in terms of engagement was much more limited than what we actually did. We got so turned on by the patient engagement process and the fascinating insights that we were getting from them that we started stacking on new engagement methods that were never in our proposal because we were learning so much. So as researchers, it's actually a very fulfilling experience, and I've been doing research for 30 years. I found it fascinating to learn how much new insight I was able to get by going to this process. So yes, it's more work, but as a researcher, I find it much more rewarding.
Yeah. I agree with what's come before, and I think it could be summed up by saying, we're actually asking for a paradigm shift. So it's not an add-on that's going to cost more money. We're talking about a transformative paradigm shift. And so back to the first question you asked, one of the biggest barriers is political will and cultural change to make that happen. I also have a more tactical comment, and perhaps this exists and I'm ignorant of it, but I was taken, Alan, by your thought that maybe there is also initial thrust, extra thrust that has to be put at the beginning of a paradigm shift like this that does create more cost and more intensive energy. So is there a way to capture the learning that is happening? I know ARC has a repository for evidence-based information. Are there ways to build a dissemination engine that identifies best practices in moving towards this paradigm shift that could be made available to all health systems? And could there be some accountability for health systems to have their own little report card on how well they are adapting and integrating some of these best practices?
Very good. We have time for a couple of questions. Please raise your hand. We have microphones. Let's take one here, one down here, and we'll have to see how we do on length of questions and answers.
Yeah, good morning. I'm Gail Hunt from the National Alliance for Caregiving, and I just wanted to really reflect a little bit on what Cindy's story was about how important the family caregiver was, because her father was not capable of talking about these decisions himself, and that's really common in older people or people with dementia or children who can't make their own minds up. And so in all of these cases, I hope that the family caregiver was included as part of the people giving input to your research.
And we actually have a paper that specifically focuses on family caregivers, but if any of you want to quickly note the role, not just of patient, but family in some of the models you discussed.
I'll just say we always think of patients, families, caregivers. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we truncate it in conversation, and I bet that's true across the board here. Folks were including caregivers as well in their work. Absolutely. Well,
but it's not a given, so.
No, that's right, good. But it's incredibly necessary.
When we talk about burdens of and patient-reported outcomes, the burdens of care fall so greatly on the families who provide care to people with chronic illness that if we don't have them, we should be expanding the patient-reported to family-reported outcomes.
And not just burdens,
there
of course, their knowledge base
measures
about what to do and what can be done and ways of doing it is extraordinary as well,
yep,
as you know.
That's true.
Can we get
Lou Gagliano, the Leapfrog Group. Doesn't the platform of the accountable care organizations, the ACO, provide a model and a platform to gather some of this data, to test it, and then to disseminate it? Because there are 80-plus organizations throughout the United States, and I would argue that if we can use that model as a platform, mm-hmm. then you can report results, look at the economic effect of that, and resources will come if the economics justify the outcomes that I think will accrue from that.
I can take that one. I think in principle the ACO model could be very helpful. The concern I have is that with looking at it through this lens of patient and stakeholder engagement is that the metrics that are being used for measuring outcomes are often those devised by health systems and societal organizations and people who are not the actual affected party. So we are advocates of an effort that would engage residents, patients, and other stakeholders who are on the receiving end of treatment to define outcome measures that matter to them, and then make that part of the metrics of measuring population health. And the other problem is that ACOs are interpreting population health as the population of patients in there that they are serving by their institution, rather than what public health people would call true population health.
Yeah, and I would like to build off of that. Within UW Medicine, so where patient-reported outcomes are initially being driven is through accountable care organizations and expectations that we capture pain and function on people for low back pain, for spine surgery, and for total joint replacement. We're using that as a platform for building a more strategic approach to capturing patient-reported outcomes. And to the point that's been made previously about population health, a lot of the measures that are being pushed for are great for looking at population changes, but not at individual care. And so we're trying to figure out how do you start to look at measures that can inform direct patient care that you can then roll up and start to look at populations to understand who is going to respond best to what treatment. So I think it's a learning process. I think it's been a great impetus for change for us, and hopefully we'll be able to do a systematic approach to incorporating PROs across the system, not just in specific areas of care.
Just one sentence, that ACOs give the flexibility to change, but they don't necessarily give the incentives the way they are now.
Well, I think I was just going to add two pieces. I think these are just really terrific and thoughtful comments. ACOs also could very much be an environment where you're thinking about not only patient engagement in their individual care, but in the organization and design, mm-hmm. right, and the policies. And I think certainly in my experiences with CMS, there's increasing interest and a receptivity to that involvement, but the execution is a complex issue. I think it's very important. I want to return to what you were talking about measurement. We are actually currently undertaking a project through the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation looking at what would patient-centered measurement be. And even if we move beyond just thinking of it as what patients report, but actually what patients view as important, what would the principles of that be and what would the implications be? And I think that is really crucial and important next terrain.
If you wait long enough, your colleagues cover all the terrain. I have one point that I'd like to add, which is that I do think ACOs are a tremendous opportunity with all these caveats in mind, as are learning health systems, and that one of the things we've been looking at is how to involve patients in the governance of learning health systems exactly. and in the governance of ACOs. And so I think that's an untapped opportunity to solve some of the problems that we've been bringing up.
100%.
So with 13 more papers to present, I'm going to have to call this panel to a close, but please join me in thanking them for their great thoughts. If we could have our next three presenters come forward, and I'll introduce, and we'll go straight through them, and then we'll have the break after. And for those in the back, there are seats in the front. If you just want to come down the side, there is room. As we're making the transition here, we're going to talk about some specific examples of patient engagement, which are included in this month's issue. You'll hear from Ming Tai-Seale, senior scientist at the Palo Alto Medical Foundation's Research Institute and a consulting professor at Stanford School of Medicine Department of Health Research and Policy. You'll hear from Jack Westfall, professor of family medicine and senior scholar at the Farley Policy Center and founder and director of the High Plains Research Network at the University of Colorado, and Miriam Garvelink, a postdoctoral fellow with Professor France Legere, the Canada Research Chair in Implementation of Shared Decision-Making in Primary Care at the Research Center of the CHU de Quebec University Laval. I'm sure I butchered the pronunciation of every syllable in that, but my apologies. Let's turn first to me.
Thank you, Alan. Good morning. I really, really appreciate that the last panel, it set up so well what I want to present to you. So I want you to think about Cindy's experience about the gurney, you know, on the wheels, about, you know, being pushed away, and she's saying, but I haven't given consent. You know, I don't know enough. So I want you to think about in primary care. I have a friend who is a primary care physician. He said some days when he arrives in the office, his nurse would say, doctor, you know, we'll skip his name. I hope you have your rollerblades on today because you got lots of patients. Okay, so think about, Jerome Groopman said, you know, cogent thinking, decision making cannot happen as if it's a race being run, right? We also know there have been many studies aimed at activating patients, you know, ask them to make lists, to bring their list to their doctors. And 3 years ago, in this very room, the podium was over there, I presented to you a study that we did with NIH funding, looking at patients are asking questions. You know, people like Cindy, you know, family members are asking questions, and physicians sometimes are not ready to answer them. So we wanted to do better. So thanks to PCORI's funding for this study and for the Palo Alto Medical Foundation and the Levy Family Fund for supplemental fundings, we embarked on this study to enhance shared decision making in primary care. And we truly followed PCORI's mandate to do research differently. We engaged with our stakeholders, we came from patients, providers, clinical staff, and user experience design consultants in this almost a 3-year journey in order to do better for our patients and our clinicians to engage, you know, help them engage in patient-centered communication. So through about a year's time of engaging with our stakeholders, we came up with this intervention, which we call open communication. It has three components. The first one is an animated video. It's really cute. And if you go to the website, you can access that little animated video. It's designed to help patients and physicians to normalize the action of jointly setting an agenda, incorporating what are most important to patients into the agenda, and defer appropriately. The second component is a booklet. It looks just like this. So it has a place for patients to write out what are important to them that they want to talk to their doctor about, and then to remind them to circle what is the most important thing they want to address. And then we made space for patients to take notes because you can't remember, right? 70% of patients leave a visit not knowing what happened, what they're supposed to do, what's the name of that medication that they're supposed to take. So we give them space to write it out. So when their doctor are working on the after visit summary, the care plan, they can write it out and then they can compare notes together. And then we remind them to teach back. So patients will verbalize what they're going to do so the doctor can make sure that they're on the same page. And there is a third component, which is standardized patient instructor. We hired an actress to portray a patient who have actually a different opinion about what the next steps ought to be. So doctor would have two visits with the standardized patient and practice the components of the open communication intervention. The evaluation design is that we used a 2x2 fully crossed cluster, the randomized control trial, to compare the open communication intervention, which I just described to you, with an existing intervention called the Ask, Share, Know questions. that basically we remind patients to ask three simple questions about the choices, you know, about what are their options, what are the risks and benefits of those options, and what's the likelihood of these risks and benefits to happen. So we recruited four clinics in primary care and randomized them into each of the sites, one per arm, and included 300 patients, that's 75 patients per clinic, and altogether we had 26 primary care providers participating. So the outcome measures, there were two main ones. One is the three-item fast and frugal way of assessing patients' perception about patient engagement done by their physicians. And the second one is a subscale in the perceived involvement in care scale on doctors' facilitation about shared decision making. So we see that the unadjusted rates, there was differences between the intervention clinics and the usual care clinics. And in terms of the adjusted odds ratio, so we used a logistic regression model and accounted for patient characteristics as well as physician characteristics. And what you can see here is the open communication arm, patients were more likely to give all nines, which is the top score, top box approach. We wanted to see the probability of patients giving the absolute best possible on a scale of 0 to 9, the best possible score. So in the open communication arm, both in terms of the collaborate score and the facilitation of shared decision making. And then in the ask arm, the facilitation of shared decision making had a higher odds ratio of happening, patients giving all top scores. So in conclusion, the enhanced shared decision making is achievable through patient-centered interventions, especially when co-designed with stakeholders. And we believe we found promising evidence of efficacy and meaningful signals of the likely effects of these interventions on patient experience with specific provider behaviors, not just a generic satisfaction with visit. We ask specifically about physicians' effort in engaging them, in understand what are the options, what are the risks and benefits. And then we want to conclude by saying that it's incumbent upon healthcare systems to echo what Cindy said. It's the system, right? So we want the system to empower patients to engage in shared decision making and to enable the providers to adopt patient-centered innovations in standard practice.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here today, and I want to thank PCORI for taking a risk on something called boot camp translation a few years ago. I want to thank my co-authors and point out Merritt Felzine and Ned Norman. You'll find a picture of Merritt here on your in the middle of the one-pager. She and Ned are farmer ranchers from Sterling, Colorado, and they wanted to join us today, but they're in the middle of calving, and so they weren't able to join us. They sent me a picture this morning of number 57 of 60. They have 60 pairs, and they're just about finished up with calving. They're co-authors on this manuscript. So it's inherently improbable that an academic researcher can ask a clinical question that matters to a patient. Now, this is the fire department in Lyman, Colorado. I was the medical director of the fire and ambulance in Lyman, Colorado, and this is the way it feels often for patients when they're asked to participate or make shared decision making. The researchers have great tools. They have the great equipment, they have the hose, but they're not quite sure where to point it. And the fire in the community is on the other side, and so it's important. And we wonder why that's the case. Well, in 1960 and then redone in 2000, Carr White looked at the population, and for every 1,000 people in the population each month, 750 of them will have an injury or an illness. 250 of those will seek medical attention, 10 will be hospitalized, and less than one of them will be hospitalized in a tertiary academic medical center. Guess where we do our research? In that itty-bitty little box there on the right-hand corner. And we wonder why it doesn't automatically flow out into the community. So here is an example. Here's the hypertension guideline, the short version. This is the short version. And I'm sorry that the U.S. Preventive Service Task Force is taking so many hits today, because they're really a delightful group of people with delightful guidelines. The U.S. Preventive Service Task Force recommends, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to read the first part, recommends screening for high blood pressure in adults age 18 and older. That's a grade A recommendation. So our community members looked at this through boot camp translation that I'm going to describe, and here are the questions that they had. What does this mean? What is screening? What is, there's mercury involved here? What, hold on a sec. I'm not sure what the mercury is doing, and what is cardiovascular? Is it my heart, my blood pressure, my stroke? Here are the questions that didn't make sense to them out of this very well evidenced guideline. So they, over a couple of years, developed and named a process called boot camp translation. It's a 6 to 8 month process that translates medical jargon into language and concepts that speak to the local community. They're locally relevant and actionable. It utilizes community member expertise. So we've heard about medical expertise and evidence expertise and community and patient expertise. I know survey methodology, and I know those hypertension guidelines very well now. But I don't know what it's like to live in Sterling, Colorado. So you need expertise to help make cultural and appropriate the recommendations. Patients and community members learn the relevance of the health condition. They become experts during boot camp translation. And then they address two main questions. What is the message to the community based on those evidence-based guidelines? And how do you want to disseminate that? Because that's what they're an expert in. They've joined their best community expertise with that best medical expertise to create something wholly new. It changes patients' views and beliefs around the medical condition. Their constructs of the condition actually change. Here's an example. We've done, with the help of PCORI, we were able to take the method that was developed in 2005 and test it in a group of communities all across Colorado, rural, urban, African-American communities, Latino communities, English-speaking, Spanish-speaking. One example of a problem that was addressed or that was prioritized by four communities was hypertension. We used one evidence-based guideline that you just saw, the U.S. Preventive Service Task Force. We had four communities, four boot camp translations, and they came up with four separate types of messages around that, making that culturally relevant and locally actionable. So in rural, the focus was really on self-management and home blood pressure. It's your responsibility. And in fact, they told us that the expectations that we had for community members weren't high enough. We should expect patients to participate more in their self-management. And that personal responsibility was the motivator. In the Center for African American Health, hypertension became part of self-management around a whole spectrum of self-management and taking care of your body as a temple. So we worked with the Center for African American Health that has a strong influence in the Black Church Initiative in Colorado and Denver. And so the body as a temple was the motivator for caring for your blood pressure. In the English-speaking Latino group, they really wanted to focus on people who didn't know they had hypertension. So out in the community, there's lots of people who've never been diagnosed. How do we address that group and really use family as a motivator? You owe it to your family to care and know your numbers. Know the numbers, what they mean and what they are. And in the Latino Spanish-speaking population, they really wanted to address people who knew they had hypertension and were avoiding treatment. And this was where this public health message, we were almost not allowed to use it because every public health person said, you're not allowed to use fear as a motivator. That's just not a good public health message. But the community said, we want people to understand the life-threatening impact of untreated hypertension. One evidence-based guideline, four communities, and four messages. What are the policy implications of that? Well, all research would benefit from all the research strategies and stages would benefit from patient engagement all along, from the deciding what to study all the way through translating the final evidence-based guidelines. Imagine if patients were more engaged in the development of research questions that mattered to them. It may cost more to do that, but you wouldn't have a whole lot of research that never gets implemented because no one cares about it. Imagine if patients were involved in the creation of evidence-based guidelines from the beginning. Would have been very nice to have 100 or 200 or 1,000 women involved in the production of the U.S. Preventive Service Task Force guidelines on mammography. That would have been a really nice benefit, and it may have made the dissemination and implementation of those that much easier. And we believe that policymakers can support and maybe even require deeper patient engagement throughout the entire medical research enterprise to ensure that the national investment that we make in research actually comes back to benefit individual patients, their families, and the communities in which they live. Thank you very much.
Good morning, and thank you for having me present here today. As a Dutch researcher who's doing a postdoc in Canada, it's a real honor to present my work in the United States of America. In the 2015 White House Conference on Aging, the President of the United States spoke about challenges and opportunities in taking care of our elderly. He mentioned that one of the best measures of a country is how it treats its older citizens. And as examples, he spoke about access to insurance and care as delivered by healthcare professionals. What he didn't mention is the importance of all the care that seniors receive outside of the health system, which is typically provided by informal caregivers, often a child or a family friend who knows the person intimately. Oh, I'm sorry, I forget my Okay. When decisions are made about the senior's care, it is important to not only involve the senior and healthcare provider, but also this informal caregiver. They can support decision-making with their unique perspective on the senior, but also because they themselves can be greatly affected by the decisions that are made about a person's care. However, caregivers are not always involved to an extent they desire, nor does current healthcare policy emphasize their important role. So we wanted to see how we could improve this. Therefore, we aim to assess the effectiveness of existing interventions to improve caregivers' involvement in decision-making with seniors, and to describe caregivers' experiences of decision-making in the absence of interventions. To this end, we conducted a mixed methods knowledge synthesis in which quantitative and qualitative data were analyzed separately according to their research design and then triangulated. We searched 9 relevant databases with search terms related to participation in decision-making, caregivers, and the elderly. And the data from the articles was extracted and synthesized as categorized by the interprofessional shared decision-making model, which I will explain in a bit. So we found over 5,000 articles, of which 66 were included, only 4 of which were intervention studies. The most often reported decisions were about location of care and end-of-life care. Caregivers were mostly female and either the spouse of an adult child of the senior, and their mean age was about 58 years old. 4 interventions aimed to involve caregivers in decision-making with seniors. 3 decision aids about feeding tube options or respite care, of which only 1 led to significantly improved decision-making outcomes with low risk of bias. The other intervention was a multifaceted intervention with addition of a trained family support specialist to the ICU care team, but this one wasn't rigorously evaluated, so we cannot really say whether it was effective or not. When no interventions were present, we extracted caregivers' experiences as categorized by the interprofessional shared decision-making model. As shown on this slide, the model represents a shared decision-making process from initiation of the decision until after decision-making, including all the possible actors from left to right, their roles, and the steps in decision-making from above to below. So we found that caregivers appreciated a supportive decision-making environment, but reported many frustrations with the healthcare systems as well. There was room for improvement with regard to empathetic doctors, good communication within interprofessional teams, and available time for decision-making. Caregivers took on a variety of roles with different extent of involvement, but were not always involved to the extent they wanted. Some felt left out, others were overly burdened with decision-making. Only one study talked about satisfaction with the caregiver role. They often receive limited information with uncertainty as a consequence and confusion when different sources provided different information. There was not always a discussion of values and needs between caregivers, staff, and seniors, and they sometimes reported limited options to choose from, which made decision making difficult and led to conflicts within and between persons involved. So although decisions often seem to be relatively uninformed and not values-based, they were yet implemented in the majority of cases. Unfortunately, with as a consequence, many negative feelings related feelings after decision-making, such as regrets, doubts, and guilt, as well as a need for coping strategies to deal with the decision. So in conclusion, we found few effective interventions to support caregivers in decision-making with the elderly, and many unmet needs, which led to negative post-decision-making sentiments. Also, the most frequent decisions were not addressed in any interventions. We suggest that more effective interventions and more rigorous evaluation of them are needed to improve caregivers' involvement in decision-making. For this, it may be promising to give special attention to the decision-making environment, such as training decision-making coaches and clinicians and use of decision aids as well as the actual environment. Thank you very much.
I'm going to start by asking sort of the corollary of the question I asked the first panel, which was about the health system side. You all are focused more on the patient side and wondered if you could highlight what you see as the primary patient side barriers to engagement as opposed to the sort of system side barriers. Assuming we had a well-designed system, what would be the biggest challenges to authentic patient engagement or the most significant barriers that you observed in the work that you did? Ming, do you want to start?
Sure, I can start. I think patients are, you know, there is quite a variation in terms of patients' readiness to be a fully engaged partner in shared decision making. Some patients have the will, but not the tools. So with our intervention, we kind of provided them the tools, and they actually wanted us to maybe make our tool even bigger, put it on the wall, so that they... So the initial hurdle would be eliminated. They would say, oh, you know, those researchers handed this to me. They wanted me to ask you these three questions. So that makes it, you know, normalizes it. So they're not paying the initial price of offering to do something different in a visit.
So I hope you'll beg an indulgence or offer an indulgence. The system part, I think I'd like to just address quickly, because I think healthcare in America has become transactional. And what engagement requires is a relational aspect. And so as we've moved towards transactions in healthcare, it makes the relationship part tougher. And so from a system standpoint, we have to reclaim the relational aspects of healthcare. From a patient perspective, I think the thing that is the barrier for us is something we call windshield time. And in Eastern Colorado, when our High Plains Research Network Community Advisory Council gets together, the group of 15 to 20 people log approximately 2,000 miles total. So it's 100 miles from anywhere to anywhere. And so to get that group together, we don't have monthly meetings for an hour, we have quarterly meetings for a full day. Because it's 2,000 miles. Everybody's driven 100 miles both ways, and some people farther. The other thing is that the reason that our two patient co-authors are not here is they have lives. This is not what they do for a living. I get paid to do this, and I get paid to do research, and it's my job. But their job is raising cattle and teaching English and taking care of a dryland wheat farm. And they're busy doing that. And so the barrier is, how do we do it so that it's respectful of their time and energy? And one of the big questions right now, I think, that we see at many of the funders is, do you pay patients to be engaged or not? And how do you do that so that it's culturally appropriate? So I think the fact that patients have lives and they're busy doing them, to get them to engage with us requires that we really take this seriously, or they're like, yeah, I'm busy. So that's, I think, a barrier.
Good.
So I think I heard great ideas already in this panel and the other panel. For example, using the time more efficient, because time is often reported as a barrier for shared decision making, but it doesn't have to be. What I think we could also pay more attention to is still to emphasize why patients should be involved in decision making and what it means to be involved, not only for the clinician, but because still often clinicians say they do shared decision making, but they're not really doing it. But also for the patient, why it is important that they are involved more.
Let me just use that last comment, Ming, to bring you back on your paper. You're in a primary care setting, and you use the term shared decision making. It sounds like it's a broader sense of patient engagement. I just wondered about the terminology. Do patients feel like they're in a shared decision making process, or is that the term you use back in the office, and they just feel like they're being patients? Is this a thing that we're teaching people to do, or are we just engaging people?
I think we do use the term shared decision making, but we don't ram it down their throat, talk about it all the time. Just like Marisham said, if we talk to physicians about shared decision making, they say, yeah, we already do it. But if we listen to audio recordings or watch videos, there's quite a variation. But for patients, I think it's not too unfamiliar if we explain what we mean by shared decision making, by their role in arriving at a decision that's patient centered, that makes sense to them, that addresses what are most important to them. So I think it's the translation part, and then not to always be using the technical term, but about communicate openly and communicate based on what are most important to you.
We have a question here, and we'll have time for a couple before we go to our break.
Thank you for this meeting. It is incredible. I am Cindy Gagan. I'm a 20-year breast cancer survivor. I'm a patient advocate, and I'm also a caregiver. And I'm kind of struck on the engagement principle, in that in advocacy, we've been doing engaging with patients in shared decision-making. I have a garage full of decision-making tools because I've been working in breast cancer for the past 20 years. So we help patients. There's that peer-to-peer support. And all this decision-making that's being made offline, not in this transaction in the office, but between patients, and the decisions that are being made aren't necessarily being made and consented in the office, they're outside. So I know there's not enough evidence to publish all of the effectiveness that we've had, but I'll tell you the reason why the USPTF mammography guidelines are so, not accepted, is because of the probably million women that we've educated over the past 20 years that early detection saves lives. So how do we transfer that learning from advocacy in grassroots community building to what needs to happen for resources? Because this doesn't require a lot of resources. There are people who really do want to help.
I don't know if any of you want to take that on. Let me try to turn the question a little bit, maybe more towards where our authors could go. So of course, we finally got an odds ratio on this panel. So we're now back into the world of research. And I'm thinking about the first half of your question, which is, if what we want is engagement, engagement and relationships, those happen in lots of different settings. And the research endeavor is much more comfortable in a controlled setting, like the one where you studied at the Palo Alto Medical Foundation. How do we understand the evidence base for something relational when it's a lot easier to study something in a transactional setting? I know that's not exactly your question, but I'm just trying to get us into, you know, health services research speak. Anyone want to try to help us with this one?
Go ahead.
I think you've been pointed.
You know, the thing that boot camp translation does is it takes a national standard and makes it more granular. And I think the granularity of a recommendation goes from sort of this national, here's the national guideline, and then the other end of the spectrum is the very personal one-on-one in the patient-provider dyad. That's the other end of the spectrum of granularity. And somewhere in the middle is how do you make this national standard locally relevant and actionable? And so the boot camp translation really tries to make it out into the community so that both the community and the providers have the same language around this to have that conversation once they get to the dyads level. And so suddenly, instead of colon cancer screening, which no one knew what that was, what screening is, primary screening, secondary screening, tertiary screening, the conversation that they had about it was remarkable. And at the end of it, the fourth grade school teacher raised her hand and said, "Oh, screening. You doctors don't know what it is." And it was sort of true. And so you start that language of being able, they said, "Isn't it a test? And if it's a test, can't we call it a test?" And from a medical standpoint, okay, you know, there's definitions that we have to use. But if you can relax the definitions so that they're culturally appropriate, not translated, not transliterated, but co-translated into and co-created at the local level, suddenly that conversation becomes very much easier at the dyad level. And so it's meaningful to the patient and the provider, not because it's a published national guideline, I'm sorry, but because it's a culturally appropriate conversation that I can have with my provider. And so it, whether or not you abide by the guideline or not, whether it's an A recommendation, B recommendation, or C recommendation, whatever, is immaterial because you've had the relational conversation about the issue.
So if I may.
Oh, sorry, yes. Oh.
Answer your question, Alan. So we started with the relationship part. You know, we really engaged with our stakeholders. We asked a lot of open-ended questions. We used up a ton of post-it notes about what are important to them, both to patients and clinicians. You know, so physicians would say, "I don't want the visit longer. I don't want you to open up a Pandora's box and tell them to just bring in very long lists." So we're mindful and respectful about their wishes, but in the same time, we recognize patients, you know, had to travel a pretty long journey from whatever you say, "Doc, you're the doctor," to, "By the way, I don't understand that. You know, can you tell me more about it? Let me say it back to you so you can tell me if I got it wrong." You know, so it took a while. So we the odds ratios came from quite a lot of pretty thick, you know, ethnographic work. You know, we took our prototypes to our clinic and had real-time feedback from patients and clinicians. So we iterated multiple times, and then we wanted to use the most rigorous method possible. So that's why we did the cluster randomized controlled trial. So it's like research, patient centered research on steroids. You know, we started by engaging with patients, but we tried to apply the most rigorous method. And then we took our stakeholders were with us when we had the results. They helped us interpret it, and they are, you know, demanding us to spread it as far and wide as we can.
Yeah, Mike.
Thanks, Alan. Mike Miller, I'm a health policy physician, I'm currently senior advisor at Foley Hoag. And I wanted to pick up on something John said about transactional versus relationship tension in healthcare. I mean, everybody's moving, the whole mantra for the last, I don't know, 5, 10, 15 years has been more patient-centered care. And the reality is, I don't think patients understand, they think that's a good thing, but taking it out of the elephant out of the shadows means if we want more patient-centered care, what we've been having is revenue-centric care. I realize maybe controversial research, but sort of put that on the table for patients to consider in their relationship with their healthcare system, with their physicians, with the hospitals, as to how that is part of the dynamic part of the relationship.
And we will have a number of papers that get more into the pricing issues, but I don't know if any of you want to weigh in on this.
So we actually ask our patients, we were all becoming patient-centered medical homes out in eastern Colorado, and the patients saw, our community advisory council saw a lecture on patient-centered medical home, and it irritated them a lot. They were like, you've named that the dumbest thing ever, because it's so not patient-centered. It's physician-centered. And they were very annoyed by it. And actually, the person who gave the talk is a very well-known Colorado expert in PCMH, and she was very hurt. And she said, okay, so I'm going to hire your group to fix it. And so she hired the group to do a boot camp translation on PCMH. And they struggled for 9 months. So, you know, our boot camp translations are supposed to last 6 to 8 months, and this was 9 months, and they weren't there yet, and they were very frustrated. And so they switched it up and used an appreciative inquiry approach to identify successful things about medical homes or business homes. So there were dental homes, and one of them talked about the successful characteristics of their auto mechanic knowing their first name when they walked in. I mean, it was pretty impressive. And they came down, and then they analyzed this data, and they came down with medical home is relationship, and everything else should be in service to that relationship. So somebody talked about the front desk calling in or somebody calling into the front desk and saying, hey, you could, if you fill this out and fill out this form, I can take these questions. That makes the front desk and the receptionist part of the relationship. Our office has just gone to a call center for the entire university. Right, so 42 primary care practices, 100 specialty practices, the hospital, the ER, the labs are all one call, which sounds awesome unless you're a patient who wants to call in and doesn't necessarily want that to be a transaction. That's a missed opportunity for a relationship of, hey, could you fill out these three questions? Can I ask you how things are going? Can I start the relationship right now? And I think we have to be very careful that it's not just in the exam room that it's transactional. It's the entire practice of healthcare has become transactional.
Okay, on that note, we are going to take a short break because we still have a lot of papers, 10 minutes. Before you run out of the room, I hope when you stand up you will look at how many people are here. It's really gratifying to see the level of interest. Please join me in thanking our panel. We'll come back in 10 minutes.
Thanks.
More papers that we want to present at the risk of this entire morning feeling more transactional than relational. We do want to make sure we can present all of these, and we know we're running well into the lunch hour, but hope that we're giving you, some good food for thought. This next panel will focus on the role of patient narratives. We'll be hearing from Dan Dohan, Associate Professor of Health Policy and Social Medicine at the University of California, San Francisco, Philip Lee Institute for Health Policy Studies, where he's also Associate Director for Training and Development. We'll hear from Holly Witteman, Assistant Professor of Medicine at Laval University in Quebec. And we will hear from Ben Renard, a graduate student at the Perelman School of Medicine at the University of Pennsylvania, and Junior Fellow at the Penn Social Media and Health Innovation Lab. I'll turn it over first to Dan.
So good morning. I think it's still the morning. I want to start by giving a shout out to PCORI and especially the methodology program, which has funded the work that we're talking about in this paper. This paper is really a thought piece, and I'm actually doing this without any slides, which I'm grateful for now, having heard the initial comments from the earlier panels, because it's given me a lot of food for thought and a new way of framing. Well, let me put it this way. I was going to start out this talk by telling you a story about a mountain bike, a tennis ball, and something called a Theracane. And I still want to tell that story. But I also want to have us reflect on the stories we've already heard from people about their experiences in the healthcare system and the research that folks have reported about patient narratives and how hard it is to integrate narrative into the healthcare experience and in a meaningful way into our healthcare system. The bottom line of what I want to say is that we think we're not quite ready to do this yet. We think we're missing some of the crucial tools that we need to actually make narrative a real stakeholder and a real player in our healthcare system. And that until we have better tools for understanding narrative and presenting narrative and living narrative in the healthcare system, it's going to be hard to push back against that transactional healthcare system. That without a better way of making narrative evidence real evidence, it's going to be very difficult to make a lot of progress in making our healthcare system truly patient-centered. And that's not to say that we aren't making a lot of progress now with learning healthcare systems, with much more patient-centered outcomes research. It's just to say, how much further can we go, and can we think more aspirationally about the way that narrative might be used in healthcare? So back to the tennis ball and the mountain bike. I still consider myself an athlete, but back 15 years ago, I really thought I was an athlete and used to mountain bike a lot in the hills and back of Berkeley, California. And at one point, I was going a little too fast and went flying off the mountain bike and ended up separating and dislocating my shoulder. And this was not a good thing. And for the next few years, about every 4 or 5 years, my shoulder would lock up, and I'd go see my doctor, and he would usually give me a shot of cortisone, and that would ease things up, and I'd do physical therapy and bands and all kinds of things. And then 4 or 5 years later, it would lock up again. And this was going on every, this is not a huge healthcare problem, not a huge cost in the system, but every 4 or 5 years I'd have to get the shoulder unlocked. Until the last time I went to see my PCP, and he said, well, you could just try putting a tennis ball against the wall and rubbing your shoulder on the tennis ball. And I was like, wow, that's great. So I tried that, and it worked. And I actually brought my tennis ball on a trip, a research trip, and I was talking to my colleague about why there was a tennis ball in my suitcase, and she said, well, there's this thing called a Theracane that does the same thing, and it's really awesome. And so I got a Theracane, and actually I got two Theracanes, one for the office and one for home. I'm not advocating or endorsing the Theracane, but it really helped a lot. And the point of this story is, I don't think there's any evidence for the tennis ball trick. And the Theracane came from a discussion with my research manager, not with any healthcare provider. And those were my shoulder's awesome now, I can tell you. No more problems with my shoulder. So we all, I think, and I know this from hearing the earlier panels, we all make healthcare decisions this way. Whether you're a clinician, you rely on your evidence and your training. Whether you're a patient, you rely on the stories you hear from family and friends. And the question is, how do we make that evidence, that narrative evidence, more vital within our healthcare system? It's really striking that we don't do it already, actually. And although we're, as I said, making some progress, it's also the case that last month the BMJ got a letter where there was a lot of protest from folks who do qualitative research, which is where narrative tends to happen, saying, BMJ was saying they're not actually going to consider publishing qualitative research in BMJ anymore. And I know this is an ongoing conversation and there's some back and forth. But the fact is, outside of narrative matters and similar kinds of columns, it's very difficult to find narrative in the healthcare evidence database. And there are really, really good reasons for this. Qualitative researchers have a difficult time making the case for their own studies and for the importance of it. We also have some real practical problems. We have problems sharing data. We have problems replicating each other's studies. And we really have a big problem with confidentiality. How do we tell stories about real people and real places without giving away who those real people and real places are? Because that's something that we don't want to do as researchers. So we've been thinking a lot about these problems. And I want to talk about just two ideas we have, one of which is going to be familiar because Ming talked a little bit about it, and the other is a little bit more aspirational. So the familiar idea is videos. And just getting videos to patients and providers, and not so much as an educational tool, but more as something that patients and providers can talk about together to sort of actively change the narrative within the exam room or wherever it may be in the healthcare system, so that we're really thinking about what should we be talking about here, what's the right vocabulary to use for this conversation, and how do we continue this conversation in a very meaningful way that we're talking about something that's important to us and not getting distracted by details, which may seem like what the decision is about, but are really, in the broadest sense, not what the conversation should be focused on. And again, I think Cindy's earlier story about how do we make the vital part of the conversation the center of the conversation, rather than focusing on the details of a particular treatment or decision making at the moment. The other thing we're thinking about is how to bring qualitative research into the era of big data. There's tons and tons of narrative data out there. Lots of studies always are already taking place. PCORI is funding a lot of narrative research, but we don't have a great way of bringing that together. And so we're also thinking about how can we aggregate narratives and make them available to patients and providers. And we're trying to do this in a way that's visual, so that people can see, what is my narrative? How does it compare to other patients' narratives? What are the patterns of narratives when people think about a particular problem? We're very far away from getting to that point. We have some prototypes, but with PCORI support, we're hoping to continue to develop that technology, something we call the ethno-array, because we actually borrow this metaphor from the basic sciences, as a way to make narrative a more vital part of what we do in healthcare and more accessible to patients and providers going forward. So I look forward to questions and answers and talking more about this important issue. Thank you.
All right. Thanks very much, Dan. I'm delighted to be here. I would like to start by acknowledging my co-authors and our funders. And I'm going to talk today about social media. And by social media, I mean anything that allows people to communicate with each other online. And in keeping with the theme of this panel, I am going to start with a story. It's my with a narrative. It's my own, because getting informed consent from myself is remarkably straightforward. In addition to my academic self, I'm also a person who has lived with type 1 diabetes since I was very young. And one of the things that has really helped me throughout my life has been ideas and tricks that I have received from other people with diabetes, primarily through social media. So what you see on the screen here are a couple of my own posts on Facebook and Twitter about a system that I learned about through social media that is user-generated, that basically what it does is it allows my husband at home to get my continuous glucose readings on his phone. And what this does is it allows me to do things like come and travel to give this talk with less fear about having a severe low blood sugar overnight that is a problem and there's no one there with me. And this is something that has actually happened to me in the past. So this, my health has significantly benefited through social media. And I know that I'm not the only person. There's quite a lot of enthusiastic literature at this point about the potential and actuality of social media to help people. And this makes a lot of sense when you think about it, because access to information and social support, these are good things. However, nothing is ever perfect. And one of the things that we know is that sometimes in social media groups, people promote practices that are contrary to evidence. And one of the things that is particularly concerning to me is this issue of polarization. So we know that the online space is becoming more splintered. And my co-authors and I had this question about, well, what does that mean when discussions become very one-sided? Everyone's oriented in the same direction. What does that mean for the people who are reading those comments? So we thought that the best experimental context for this would be something that's kind of controversial. There are plenty of those. We ran a small pilot study where we looked at four different contexts. And we decided that the one that we were going to use for the main study was home birth, because we felt that it was the most broadly accessible of all of them. We looked at some others, like some of them have been mentioned already today, changes in guidelines about breast cancer screening and so on. But we felt that most adults have either given birth, witnessed a birth, or at least have some idea of what's involved. Whereas cancer screening, advanced directives, some of the other things we considered are not necessarily broadly familiar, particularly to younger people. So to set up the study, we took six actual news articles, and we constructed a very carefully balanced article by taking sections of all of these real articles. These are their headlines up there. They're all referenced in the paper. And then we looked at the comments that had been posted on these six articles, and we purposefully assembled a set of 40 comments, 20 that were against home birth and 20 that were in favor of home birth. And within each set of 20, we had 10 that were more general comments and 10 that contained personal narratives. So the writer was writing about something that they said happened to them. And then we ran an online experiment with a diverse group of US adults whom we recruited through an online panel. And you can see here that everyone read this same mock news article. But we randomized people into one of six arms. So the arm on the left, those people were offered 10 comments that were against home birth without any stories in them. Next to that, we have people who were offered 10 comments against home birth, but with stories included. On the right-hand side, we have that same setup, except the comments were in favor of home birth. And in the center, we have one arm where the comments were balanced. We had 5 for and 5 against, and we had a control condition where people had no comments. So people went through this. They read the article, they may have read the comments, and then we asked them, overall, what's your opinion of home birth? And people indicated their opinion on a scale from 0 for an extremely negative opinion to 100 for an extremely positive opinion. So higher numbers indicating more positive opinion. And what we see is that the presence of comments, the presence of one-sided comments, swayed people in that direction, somewhat more so when there were stories involved. There's no real difference between what we see in the group of people who got balanced comments versus no comments, but people who were exposed to one-sided comments, this did seem to influence their opinion. And for the scientists in the crowd who are interested in more detail, we've got this lovely violin plot in the appendix. Download the appendix with more information about the distribution, as well as secondary outcomes and our moderating variable. So what does this mean, and where are we going from here? I think fundamentally what we all want, what everyone here is here today to talk about, is that we want to support people in making evidence-informed decisions that align with what matters to them. And one of the problems we have is that when people are exposed to one-sided discussions, that may interfere with that goal. Now, in some cases, that may be okay. You know, it may not be such a problem if someone reads a lot of comments about how great everyone feels when they're physically active. But most health decisions are more equivocal than that. A lot of health decisions are preference sensitive, and it really matters what the individual's values are, what their preferences are. And when they are swayed by other people's stories, I think that is kind of problematic. Having said that, this is not a call to remove comment sections, and it's certainly not a call to, hey, let's shut down social media. I mean, good luck with that. You try. You know, this genie is not going back in the bottle. And so one of the things that I think we need to think about when we are putting information online, this is my area of specialty of digital media for health decision making, we need to think about facilitating discussions that are respectful and that reflect the evidence in order that, as Dan was saying, stories and personal accounts can be shared in a meaningful way and integrated into decisions with my added point without unduly biasing those opinions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone, for coming out today. I'm Ben Renard, and I'm a graduate student at the University of Pennsylvania, and will be heading down to Duke University shortly to begin my internal medicine residency. Thank you. I worked with a great team of health services researchers and computer scientists to look at what could be learned about patient perspectives, hospital quality, from online consumer reviews of hospitals. Online reviews are everywhere. Just last week, I was looking at Amazon.com at laptops, And similar to how I make most of my decisions these days about buying things, I read a ton of reviews. Reading these reviews, it was easy to see what characteristics of laptops were most important to consumers. For example, everyone wrote about battery life as something that was important to them. Now, most people these days would not buy a laptop without reading reviews. Is healthcare really so different? This month's issue of Health Affairs is all about patient engagement and patient as consumers. In our article, we work to identify the aspects of hospital care that are most important to patients by analyzing what patients are actually writing about when they review their care online. Our study looked at over 16,000 Yelp reviews from more than 1,300 hospitals and compared the content in the Yelp reviews to the official government survey of hospitalized patient experience. This survey is called the Hospital Consumer Assessment for Healthcare Providers and Systems Survey, which is a mouthful. I'm also just going to call it HCAPS. Let me tell you briefly about Yelp and HCAPS, and then we'll get to some results. Yelp is a free platform where consumers can rate businesses and services on a 1 to 5 star rating and also leave narrative reviews. It has over 140 million unique monthly users, and it's the most widely used, freely available platform for rating hospitals online. HCAPS is a validated survey created for the federal government that measures the hospitalized patient experience. Results are publicly reported on a government website called Hospital Compare, and results are also used in part to determine reimbursements for hospitals. In our study, we used natural language processing to analyze the content of Yelp reviews and compared this to the major areas or domains found in HCAPS. Our study had three main findings. First, people actually review hospitals on Yelp, and these reviews can be quite nuanced. There were over 2.9 million words worth of reviews that we looked at. And as you can see in this figure here, while the ratings were bimodal, they do cover the full spectrum of patient experiences, with the average review having 170 words and talking about 11 different topics. Our second main finding is that average Yelp review rating correlates to HCAPS ratings of hospitals. Over here on the x-axis, you can see the Yelp rating of a hospital, and on the y-axis is the systematically collected HCAPS overall rating of hospital, which is a specific item on the HCAPS survey. Our third finding is that the Yelp topics we identified through natural language processing included 7 of the 11 different HCAPS domains, but they also included new areas that are not found in HCAPS. These new areas included caring and comforting physicians, nurses, and staff. Now, we thought caring and comforting were particularly interesting because they actually showed up in focus groups that were held in the early 2000s as part of the research leading up to the design of the HCAPS survey, where patients said caring, comforting, kindness were important aspects of hospital quality. Caring and comforting are not specifically asked about in the HCAPS survey per se, but instead HCAPS broadly reports how well does your doctor or how well does your nurse communicate with you. And notably, caring is the most prevalent topic in Yelp reviews. Billing, insurance, cost are other areas that are in Yelp reviews and not found in HCAPS. And these are areas that, as physicians, we don't think about as much, but are potentially important to patients. And finally, some Yelp topics were about specific areas of care or even the technical aspects of care. HCAPS notably is about the general inpatient experience, but if you're a patient, say a pregnant woman, you may care about the OB-GYN care and the labor and delivery floor and not care about the whole hospital experience, and definitely not about the transplant experience for a cardiac patient. And then as you can see in this table, the topics found in Yelp but not in HCAPS often had the strongest correlations with positive and negative Yelp ratings, indicating potential importance. Caring, comforting had a strong correlation with positive Yelp ratings, and things like insurance and billing and cost had a strong correlation with negative Yelp ratings. Online consumer reviews and traditional survey-based measures do have complementary advantages. Online reviews like Yelp are real-time, can describe the exact nature of the positive or negative experience that occurred, have narratives that are often relatable to patients, are on platforms that are generally familiar to consumers, are often free, and include not just patients, but also caregivers and family members. HCAPS, however, and similar systematic surveys do have significant advantages. For one, HCAPS is a validated survey and is the product of years of measurement research. It's also validated in the sense that it is sent to known patients who have recently been hospitalized, whereas potentially anyone can write a Yelp review. It's also systematically sent out to patients over set periods of time, and it's sent to significant samples of patients from all hospitals. In conclusion, I am not arguing that we should be replacing HCAHPS with online consumer reviews. But I do believe consumer reviews contain important information that could be helpful to patients, to policymakers, and to hospitals. Patients who are familiar with these platforms may actually prefer receiving some quality information in the narrative format. Policymakers can learn about the topics that are important to patients and also caregivers by what they're actually writing about in these reviews, and can also try and leverage these platforms to engage patients in their care. And hospitals can identify specific positive experiences to replicate and negative experiences to try and improve to improve the overall patient experience. And finally, I'd like to leave you with a parting thought. Customer service is not something that we generally think about in healthcare. And healthcare is definitely not the same as selling laptops online. However, there shouldn't be anything stopping us from providing high-quality technical care and also a pleasant patient experience. Especially as patients are increasingly paying more out-of-pocket costs, they should be empowered to choose both the high-quality technical care and the patient-centered care. Thank you.
Acknowledging your final observation that you're not advocating a replacement of CAHPS with Yelp, I do want to ask one question to sort of get the all three of you thinking about something that comes to my mind as we have a set of papers on patient narrative. There, I see two different ways of thinking about patient narrative, and you've each come at it from a combination of them, and I'd just like to try to bring them together. One is sort of the salience of narrative, that as a human being, real human experience speaks to me in a different way than a data table, and we all make our decisions based on narratives because they're salient. But the other issue that comes up in these papers is aggregating narrative. And aggregating narrative raises a whole different set of issues, because whenever we do data analysis, we sort of accept that an individual narrative is going to be biased because it's the perspective of the person. But when we aggregate, we want to squeeze out possibilities of bias because otherwise the aggregation is not reflective of the population as a whole. So I saw a mixture of both of these going on in the work that you all present. On the one hand, the importance to the user of having the salience, but also the aggregation. And I wonder if you could reflect on if we are moving more into a world, and as we integrate narrative more into our thinking, how do we balance or take advantage of these two, or am I leaving another construct out entirely? Who wants to take on that very simple question?
So I think that's a great question, and I think we can look to some current platforms to how they address this problem. So if you are on Yelp or you're on Amazon, and say you're reading reviews of a restaurant, they highlight that everyone's talking about the bacon cheeseburger. And then you go and read the actual narrative reviews, and you can find out specifically, oh, it's the wood-smoked bacon that's really the key point. So you can get the details from the narratives, but they pull out sort of and aggregate some of the salient features for you to review. And so I think the same thing could potentially be said for hospital care, where we can aggregate reviews to pull out salient points. But also, what's the difference between a 4-star rating for communication and a 5-star rating for communication? That doesn't mean anything to me as a patient. But if I can read reviews of the 4-star providers and the things they're doing and the reviews of the 5-star providers, I might get some concrete things that this provider is doing that gives them that extra star.
So the technology for talking about salient narratives hasn't changed much in the last couple hundred years. We write books. Sometimes we write shorter articles, and that's how we tell our narrative stories. We all acknowledge that these narrative stories matter a lot, and how we talk to each other about things shapes our decision making. It just feels like we're not taking it as seriously as we need to as a research community. I actually don't think we're very close to solving this problem, but we're not that far away. I mean, a couple decades, a couple tens of millions of dollars, that's sort of chump change in the basic biomedical sciences. And yet, we find it hard to get a project together like that in health services research. And I think it's time to think about whether this problem is tricky enough and important enough that it's worth coming up with some new stuff. So we're trying to put some ideas out there. I didn't show any slides because honestly, where we are right now is so crude, it's almost embarrassing. But there's two things I want to just quickly share. One is a very academic article by a guy named Andy Abbott that he wrote at the end of the 90s called, and I'll just tell you the title, Beyond General Linear Reality. So let's get beyond a regression model and think about how the world actually works. And the second thing is that a lot of this work was inspired by an article in the New York Times by Gina Collada explaining about how to interpret new genetic information about breast cancer tumor types. And what was remarkable about this article was it was like super cutting edge research about the gene sequencing of breast tumors, and it was totally comprehensible. And so I think we should think about how we get beyond general linear reality and think about models from other fields where they're really attacking this problem and recognize how important it is for us to understand.
So I will also tackle this very simple question. We can solve this today, right? We're going to solve all these problems today. So I think that particularly from my perspective, and you know, I'm an engineer, I'm a human factors engineer, and so I deal with this thing of how do we design systems that work for users. And I think that from my perspective, and certainly from the study that I presented, I think the thing that we need to be looking at is not just how can systems like Yelp and so on work on their own, and what's the underlying algorithm behind it, but what kinds of other kinds of expertise do we need to bring in to essentially help filter narratives? Because the people who have access to specialized evidence, and that doesn't necessarily have to be researchers. You know, if evidence were more available to the public, I think there are ways that we could reflect evidence better with synthesized narratives and groups of narratives.
Very good. Millie, you have a... Come, let's get a microphone to you.
Thanks. Those were great presentations. I hope I can pose my question succinctly enough. I want to preface it by saying that my own training years ago was in qualitative research, and so it's thrilling, and we had to kind of fight our way into health services research, so it's thrilling to see it being so promoted. Its time has come. That said, we're a room full of policymakers. And Holly, your talk was so important to say if we're going to use narrative, we have to include, and it's important for the range of views to be out there, then we have to be sensitive to being sure that we use narrative equitably to both sides. I want to raise what I think is another challenge, which is when you're making public policy, sometimes stories, even if you don't have a second side, like one side of the policy issue, you can invoke narrative and you see lots of advocacy groups having urgency narratives. And the policy implications, you can't really find a poster case for it. And so the overuse of narrative has, in my view, skewed some of the policy debates. And I'll just give you two examples. One very close to my own area of expertise is around the legalization of aid in dying. It's very, very easy to come up with case studies of people who have been hurt because they haven't had this option. It's almost impossible to come up with, you know, stories that on the other side that would illustrate the policy issues that might be at stake for people who don't want to legalize it. And a second example would be compassionate use. Very easy to come up with the stories of people who really, you know, should be pressuring for compassionate use, and very hard to tell a narrative about what some of the downsides are. So my question is, how do we both take the wisdom you have in making sure if we're going to use narrative, it's balanced, but also kind of have mindfulness about where telling stories cannot and might actually skew policymaking?
I think that wins for being even more difficult to answer than my question. Not that this is a competition, but who wants to try to take it on?
I'll start.
Great question.
So that's a really good question. I guess I think, you know, in the I'll focus on one of those examples. You know, assisted dying is very recently become legal. I think I'm not a legal expert, so I'm not sure exactly, but it's a big deal. In Canada it just happened, right? So across the country now, and the first person just died in Manitoba. I guess I would push back a little bit on the fact that there isn't a story on the other side. There's always a story, right? The question is, do you have an individual that you can point to and so on? But you can certainly think about things such as, you could come up with the idea of people who are making an uninformed decision and so on. I mean, I guess there's the question of, do stories have to be real stories? Or can they be archetypes? Can they be, this is the kind of thing that could happen, and let's construct an archetype about it?
Other?
I would also just mention, I mean, stories and narratives are not going anyplace, especially in the policy process. You know, we've been doing politics for thousands of years. We've always done it the same way. I think the question is how to get narrative into the scientific evidence base. That's what I see as the real challenge, so that there's some balance in the scientific community about, we can measure it, we can get our odds ratio, but we can also tell a compelling, true, reliable story about how this played out in people's lives.
Well, and it seems like that sort of is actually where Ben ended, which is, this is not an either or.
Absolutely.
There's value to both. If it's real quick, we'll get one more in, but let's get a microphone to this person and keep it quick and we'll.
Great, thank you. Lena Walker from AARP. I just wanted to follow up on Dan's last comments. So I think including the narrative as part of the scientific process would be a tremendous contribution. But part of that scientific process needs to acknowledge that there is context to every narrative. And so part of the data collection process needs to include that context. So we argue that services should be provided based on the preferences and goals of the individual. So if you don't have that data point, for instance, you might see a narrative where it's, you know, it's in support of something, and another narrative that's against something might be completely valid given the individual's goals and preferences. So I would argue for definitely creating a scientific rigor to it, but also thinking about the contextual data and evidence.
Yeah, and I would just say that's exactly what we'd love to see, that in one glance you could see the decision as well as the context in which that decision occurred, and you wouldn't lose things.
Please join me in thanking our presenters. I'll call up two papers that we have focused on report cards before we move to our final panel. Come on up, Steve. We're going to hear from Marcela Parion, assistant professor in the Department of Health Systems Management and Policy at the University of Chicago, and from Stephen Findley, independent health policy analyst, researcher, editor, and writer, contributing editor for Consumer Reports, and former senior director for communications at the National Quality Forum, who are meeting today as well. So let me turn it over to you, Marcela.
Thank you so much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here, and it has been a very fun talk. Just a clarification, I'm now at the University of Colorado. I'm an assistant professor, and I was before at the University of Chicago, where I was a grad student, and this was part of my work as a grad student, and it was a very, very exciting experience. And on behalf of my co-author, thank you again for this invitation, and ARC for funding. So I'm going to talk about the quality of the role of quality reporting of information in nursing homes. Just to give you a background, most of you are familiar that the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services has been publishing quality reports of information of nursing homes. And in 2008, it simplified the ratings, and we were just talking about Yelp, so they created something that is very similar to Yelp. Now there are 5 stars, 1 to 5 stars, and it's very easy for consumers to understand, presumably. although the evidence that actually consumers respond to quality ratings has always been mixed, it's very hard in the data to find any effect in terms of admissions to nursing homes or in terms of market share. And when I talk about consumers, I truly mean consumers and their agents. In the case of people going to nursing homes, it's usually children, grandchildren, and friends. But I guess that I was trained as an economist at the University of Chicago, so I keep using the word consumer, so apologies for that. Sometimes economists have to apologize often. So the previous research has always has been quantitative, and we wanted to qualitatively assess how consumers decide when they have to go to a nursing home. There are two greatest studies, but they were in the early 90s and the early 2000s, and you probably know that in technology time, that those are prehistoric times. That was before the internet, before iPhone. So our objective was to assess the role of quality information in consumer choices of nursing homes. And in particular, we wanted to understand to what extent consumers use the internet, and specifically nursing home compare, the website that CMS publishes where the quality ratings are. And we wanted to understand how consumers define quality. What do they understand by quality of nursing homes, and what do they want to see in the ratings? And we also wanted to understand what are the obstacles for choosing a nursing home. For choosing a nursing home of better quality, because at the end, that's the rationale behind the quality ratings, is that hopefully that's going to motivate consumers to choose providers that are of better reported quality, and that in turn is going to motivate providers to improve on their quality. Methods, we did in-depth semi-structured interviews of 63 individuals involved in recent decisions to admit a family member or a friend to a nursing home. We did this in the Chicago area, so all our sample was from Chicago. We focused on long-term because we wanted to explore obstacles that are common to people who usually have to finance long-term nursing home care using Medicaid, and that's usually a problem. So our focus was on long-term, but as you probably know, a lot of admissions that end up being long-term admissions usually start as a post-acute admission, so our sample also had people who initially went to a nursing home because of a post-acute admission. And our results, and I'm obviously trying to stay in time, and this is a very brief summary of all our results and what I think are the most important results. The process of choosing a nursing home hasn't changed from the previous results, and it's fairly similar and fairly consistent for all our respondents. They follow recommendations from physicians, from the hospitals. They gather opinion from friends and relatives. They like to visit the nursing home. More respondents actually said that they use the internet, because we all use the internet now. Probably half of you are on the internet right now. The role of nursing home compare, and this was probably our biggest surprise, is that most respondents were not aware of nursing home compare. This was definitely a surprise, because we wanted to ask them questions about nursing home compare, and they didn't know what was nursing home compare. If they didn't know, we showed them screenshots of nursing home compare, and still they didn't know what was nursing home compare. They were skeptical at the beginning because they all had responses such as, we all know that we cannot rely on the information on the internet. Everybody can put anything on the internet. When they learned that it was actually a website created by CMS, they were a lot more accepting of the information. And they all view it as a tool to maybe start a search to kind of, not as a substitute for actually visiting the nursing home or being more involved, but actually as a tool to narrow down their searches. The role of Medicaid. Reliance on Medicaid definitely limits choices for consumers. And the lack of bed availability is a problem. The concept of proximity, particularly in Chicago, if you have visited Chicago, you probably know that the south of Chicago and the north of Chicago are extremely different. They're actually, distance-wise, they're very close. It's not more than 5 miles. But for a lot of people that don't have a lot of resources, they have to take public transportation. And actually going from the south of Chicago to the north of Chicago is very complicated. So distance becomes a problem in that sense, because it takes an hour, an hour and a half to to go from the south to the north of Chicago. And in the north of Chicago are usually the nursing homes that are of better reported quality. That's another finding for another paper that we did. And there's also a long waiting list for Medicaid beds. And one fun thing about doing this qualitative research is that you get actual quotes from people, and the two quotes on the slides are very representative of their view of having Medicaid as insurance. It's like some nursing homes right out told us, we don't take Medicaid, sorry to waste your time. Or another person said, once they hear Medicaid, you know, they give you a cold shoulder. Finally, we asked consumers what would they like to see in the ratings. And again, I want to emphasize that they all like the information. They all like the five stars. Everybody shops on Amazon, everybody checks Yelp. They really like it. But they wanted to see more information about residents' activities, classes, exercises, trips. They wanted to know about cost. They wanted to know about customer satisfaction, and they wanted to hear testimonials from residents. In other words, they just wanted to have a sense of how it's going to be the life of their relatives in the nursing home. They were most interested in that. They were not so interested in a lot of the information that is actually published on Nursing Home Compare. And the implications, of course, that efforts to expand Nursing Home Compare should focus on awareness and trust. Obviously, they should also be careful that their ratings actually represent quality of care, which is a big problem, as you probably know, in any type of rating. And consumers, and CMS should also consider adding elements of interest to consumers, and reliance on Medicaid is associated with challenges that limit the importance of quality reports. I mean, it doesn't matter that they know where the good nursing homes is if they can actually not go to the good nursing homes. And since I was very good with timing, let me say quickly that how great it was to do a qualitative study, and how useful it was. We are all, I'm probably preaching to the choir, but remember, I was trained as a health economist by a statistician, and actually talking to people, this is one part, we are also writing a paper now on interviewing with nursing homes and nursing homes administrators. It was incredibly useful to make sense of my dissertation, which uses regression discontinuity to measure the effect of rating. It was an incredible experience to actually understand where is the data coming from. A lot of my statistician professors told me, you have to know your data, and you actually know your data, your data set. But it's very important to gain more context about how that data set came to be. And definitely, I love mixed methods, and I hope that more people keep doing them because they complement each other very well. They are not separate pieces. They need to be complemented. Thank you.
Great. Hi. How are you? I want to thank Health Affairs and Alan for allowing me to contribute to this issue and to be here today. It's always a special privilege to be published in Health Affairs, even though my family long ago barred me from taking Health Affairs on vacations. I was taking 2-3 copies, and they just, you know, removed it. I literally, my wife took it out of my suitcase one time. I love the journal.
This is why we have the iPad app.
that's right. I get secret.
You can cheat.
But it's always a privilege, and thank you very much. So this is my commentary and analysis. That's what it was. It's not a hard research-based kind of paper like many you've heard from today. It's sort of an overview, of the area of public report cards and provider ratings. Quick history, I won't dwell too much in the interest of time. I'm going to try to beat the clock too. We've been doing this for 30 years. We don't yet have it right, but we're getting better. We are getting better at this. It all started in 1987 with Medicare and the hospital mortality ratings, and tellingly, that was quite controversial. There are some of you in the audience that may remember the breakout of fights over that. And it was sort of killed within 3 or 4 years, mostly by the hospitals. And that's telling because we continue to do this, try hard to do ratings, provider ratings, hospitals and physicians, and there's a lot of pushback from the providers. And it's a constructive dialogue. There's not a lot of yelling in the room, but it is a tough thing to do. So 30 years, and we're still working on it hard. I want to make the point on this slide that the media has been involved from the very beginning. And we don't often pause to think about that, but it's really true. U.S. News took the lead at Best Hospitals in 1990, and Consumer's Checkbook, Top Doctors. Both of those are still underway. I'm sure everyone in this audience is familiar. And the government stepped up to the plate again, even after the hospital mortality stuff, and launched the Compare sites. Nursing Home Compare was among the first, and Hospital Compare came along in 2005. 2007 was a particularly big year, but I won't dwell on that. There's a long sort of list online and in the paper about the hallmarks and milestones in the area of provider ratings. So I had this idea that what I would do is, since there wasn't any really ready available data except from some internet traffic places on the traffic to these sites, to public reporting sites, and all the efforts were underway. There were over 200 of them underway of hospital ratings and physician ratings and nursing homes. So I had the brilliant idea of just getting on the phone and calling them, as many as I possibly could. And those who would give me data, I said, thank you very much. And it's a mixed bag of data. I don't have precise trend data. It's really a snapshot of data from 2015. And there's no data in the paper on the time people spend on rating sites. That's the next project, actually, I want to do, because that's very important. If a million people are going to health grades and spending 7 seconds, that's not very useful. We think they are spending more time. One big point I discuss in the paper is there are two forms of physician ratings, and we're all hearing about them more and more and participating more and more. One is the consumer review sites like HealthGrades and ZocDoc and Vitals.com. Millions of people are now going on these sites and using them, and about 5% of the population has rated them. The other kind is the public reporting that many of you in this room are familiar with, ratings based on quality metrics and patient experience like CAPS. There is far more traffic, as you will see in the paper, to the former than the latter, far more by magnitude of 10 or more. Basically, about 1 in 4 consulted a consumer review site in 2012, and 1 in 10 by comparison saw any clinical quality data, and far fewer people actually use that data. But the 1 in 4 figure, that's 25% of the adult population who are aware of and consulting and using the consumer review sites on physicians and hospitals. That's not insignificant. And there's new evidence. Actually, I saw a piece of data the other day. It said it was up more around 35 to 40%. So I also discussed in the paper how we're going to improve ratings. There's universal agreement, bipartisan, nonpartisan agreement. And by the way, all of ratings have occurred under Republican administrations, Democratic administrations. There's a lot of agreement and consensus around the fact that this is something that has to happen to give consumers more information on which they can base their decisions on their providers. There's positive signs of growing interest in the metrics versus just the reviews. Physician Compare, we FOIA'd HHS and CMS to get the nursing home data, hospital compare data, and physician compare data. Physician Compare had 5.3 million unique page views in 2015. That was 2 million more than Hospital Compare. That was fairly surprising to me. ProPublica also got a lot of attention to its surgeon ratings after the release in July 2015, about 2 million page views. There's broad agreement, again, as I said, that both need to be improvement. There are pros and cons to both. There are issues with both kinds of ratings. They're quite different, the consumer reviews versus the more hard-nosed, research-based and more validated metrics. The paper offers discusses these and offers up some recommendations. So where do we go from here? I'm not going to beat the clock, but almost. So I think we all know it's time. It's time. We're in the age of transparency, and provider ratings are going to get better. They are getting better. It's a slow process. Again, 30 years working on it. But there's tremendous effort underway. The government, CMS, has committed last year a very serious level to make the compare sites better and to even market them. We need, I think, to leverage the popularity of the review sites with millions of people going to them to build awareness and use of the quality metrics and a patient experience. I don't have a magic formula for how we're going to do that, but I think we all ought to be thinking about how we're going to do that. Both serve a purpose. As you've heard with several presentations today, a narrative, that stuff is really popular, and we're not going to lose consumer reviews of doctors and hospitals. They're going to happen. We need to make quality ratings, quality metrics, so based on CAPS and detailed quality clinical quality measurements, much easier and engaging to use. I really believe strongly, and I've talked to the people at CMS, and maybe some of you have too, that they need to market the compare sites and improve them, make them better user experience for consumers. And media has been a leader here, but they need to partner with researchers, and some of these points are made in the paper. One final point is we thought EHR data was going to revolutionize this area as well as every other area in healthcare starting 10 years ago. That has not happened yet, but I think it still has the potential to be very important here and bring us measurements, clinical measurements that are going to be much more easy, more salient, and more meaningful for consumers. Thanks very much.
I just want to quickly pick up on a point both of you made, which is the relative underutilization of the government sites. And yet it seems like, at least from your work, that the credibility went up when people realized that they were from an official source, not just sort of something you find on the internet. And yet we know from the prior panel, and Steve, your overview, that there are a lot more users in the other space. So is it realistic to really push these out? Do they need to be merged into something that's more like what people are used to on the comment side? I'm just curious where we go, given that you both felt like we need to do better.
Well, I think we're going to have a parallel track in the next 5 to 10 years where gradually we, because it's hard work to do it, we improve speaking about the compare sites, we improve them. CMS is dedicated to that. I'm part of an effort, as are a bunch of other people, including a lot of patients and consumers, to look at the language they use and literally parse out almost every word, every paragraph. We're in our second wave of doing that now. That's on Hospital Compare. So I think that's going to happen. But as I said, to repeat my point, I think the government understands they're going to have to market these. And of course, there was a presentation in the last panel, social media. That's the way we're going to have to go.
Yeah, to emphasize like that point, I think that it's more a problem of publicity and access more than usability. At least the Nursing Home Compare is a very nice site that you can search things by distance and see a nice Google map with icons. But the fact that Yelp and Amazon are popular is not an accident. I mean, they invest a lot in advertising and we were a little bit surprised that more people didn't use those websites, because if you Google about choosing nursing homes, I mean, Nursing Home Compare comes up very highly. So at some point we were suspicious that maybe they were not understanding that was Nursing Home Compare. But I think that the problem is more knowledge and advertisement, and obviously they can still be improved, the websites, but I think it's mostly about access to them and publicity.
And public education.
Yeah.
Take a question here, one here, and then we're going to move to our final panel. Let's get a microphone over. We record. I'd like it on the.
I think this is really a fascinating conversation, and I'll try to be quick. Indulge me for a moment.
I need you to be real quick.
Yeah. Two key pieces I'd like you to address, though, that go unaddressed when you talk about publicity. One is, back to earlier points, how much is this information connecting to the issues that patients really care and understand about? Yeah. Right? So publicity, if you're pushing something out, are you pushing out something that really is going to resonate with people? I think it's a really crucial issue. And maybe I'll leave that as sort of the most fundamental issue because it ties to all the previous conversations. You can't use something if you don't know how it relates to the outcomes that you care about or you want. And the other thing to talk about is in the history, how much patients really sat at the table in terms of defining what was meaningful versus being consulted about it.
Yeah. Well, I think we've had a many years process now with the clinical measurement and National Quality Forum and many others involved in that discussion. There are there's broad consensus now. There's way too many measures, and that way too many of them don't really translate down to the consumer level and the family level. And I think we're grappling with that, but it's just tough, as you well know.
To make my answer super quick, yes, you are completely right.
Yeah, right. Agree.
Thank you. I will make it really fast. So I wonder if CMS is investing in like optimizing the search results. So to put it, I mean, I think if they pay Google, you know, they will be able to move up right in the display of the results. Is CMS considering that as an option?
I don't know if they do that already. That's a good question. But whatever they're doing, it's not enough because I think we could all go online. You can do it right now and Google something about related to hospital comparisons or whatever in your local area. And hospital compare won't necessarily be the first site that comes up, depending on how you phrase the question. It'll be in there, though. Physician compare, I've done that on physician compare, and that comes up, and nursing homes as well. Yeah. So it's in the mix. But search engine optimization, social media, I think all of that stuff is going to be enhanced, but should be better than it is now.
So I think it does depend on which product line you're talking about, because there's a lot more competition in some of the spaces than there is
yeah.
in others.
Yeah.
Okay, please join me in thanking our presenters. We'll bring up our last panel. So while by their congressional charter, PCORI does not have cost in its purview at health affairs, and when you talk to patients and consumers, they're very interested in the price side of the equation as well. So our final panel is going to focus on the interplay between the price and quality as information that consumers and patients can use. We'll be hearing from Mark Fendrick, Professor of Internal Medicine in the School of Medicine, Professor of Health Management and Policy in the School of Public Health, and Director of the VBID, Value-Based Insurance Design Center at the University of Michigan. We'll hear from Jessica Green, Professor in the George Washington University School of Nursing and Associate Dean for Research. We'll hear from Charlene Wong, a pediatrician at the University of Pennsylvania Children's Hospital of Pennsylvania, and a Robert Wood Johnson Foundation clinical scholar. We'll hear from Peter Ubel, Associate Director of Health Sector Management, and the Madge and Dennis McLaughlin University Professor at Duke University, and Anna Sinaiko, Research Scientist in the Department of Health Policy and Management at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. I'll turn it over first to Mark.
Thank you, Alan. It is a great pleasure to be here. I'm watching the clock, and as a capitated physician, I will be done early. If I were fee for service, I would certainly go over like everyone else. I'm thrilled to be back here with Health Affairs, because when Health Affairs published the first paper on value-based insurance design in 2007, people said I published and I still perished. So it's for those of the friends of the audience hearing me talking about VBID, our kids will not know what it is to sound like a broken record, but certainly, Marcy Nielsen, you know that we know what sounding like a broken record is. I've been talking about this for a long time and really pleased to be here. The concept of value-based insurance design, for those who have not heard of it, is a insurance product that actually sets consumer cost sharing not on the cost of the service, but in fact the health value that's produced. And what we basically do is make it easily or more accessible for consumers to get the high value stuff, or the stuff that I'd like to think the evidence says that we should beg them to do, and also makes it harder for people to get the services that harm them. And if you look at this comparison, you'll see that in most commercial health plans and public health plans in the US, people are being asked to pay more, and they're being asked to pay more for everything. And they, maybe more importantly, these increases in cost sharing are directly malaligned with alternative payment models that are asking the health plans to pay doctors to do certain things more often. So imagine the situation where I am paid more to get my patients with diabetes to get an eye doctor, and the fastest growing type of health plan in the US doesn't cover a diabetic eye exam at all until a deductible is met. So the VBID approach hopefully is intuitive. It lowers cost sharing for high value services and providers. Evidence after 15 years would suggest it does enhance patient outcomes, and maybe most importantly, as we move from volume to value on the payer side, we will now align better with what's going on the provider side regarding moving away from fee-for-service to, in fact, a quality-based system. So we've seen a number of implementations of value-based insurance design most recently. I think the most cutting edge, which is featured in our paper, is what happened in the state of Connecticut after Governor Malloy was elected in 2010. And when he was faced initially on his first day in office was a huge state budget deficit. And he had heard from many of his consultants that you could get a lot of money by reducing health care benefits. But at the same time, there were motivations from many stakeholders, particularly the consumers and the enrollees, as well as the employees, that one, we identified that we were not getting enough health for the money, and that many of the quality metrics that had been identified were actually being suboptimally reached. At the same time, there was this movement that is actually coming to a nice pinnacle today, Alan, that we want to encourage consumers more in their care, in their pursuit of the healthcare delivery. And most importantly, what motivates me as a clinician and just about everyone in the room is, you know, we are not in the healthcare business to make money. We are hopefully in the healthcare business to improve individual and population health. And I'm not afraid to tell audiences that I did not go to medical school to save money, nor did any of the proud clinicians that I work with around the country. We have a different set and a different mission, I think, to many of the fiscal constraints that are discussed around the country and particularly in this town. So we were very fortunate through a multi-stakeholder dialogue to implement a plan called the Health Enhancement Plan based on the VBID principles, which most importantly was voluntary. Secondary, it continued the ACA mandated full preventive coverage. It then went further and reduced cost sharing for high value services for chronic diseases. It increased cost sharing for unnecessary ER visits, kind of adding a little bit of a stick, a tiny step into the stick direction. But most importantly, different from other VBID programs, is this plan had a participatory requirement. And this was something that had to go through multiple iterations of multiple stakeholders to basically say, if you don't do those things, go to your doctor for your mammogram or your pap smear or your flu shot, or if you have a chronic disease, to get your blood sugar under control or your diabetic eye exam, you will be politely asked to leave the plan, to go into a plan that was $100 more a month with a higher deductible. And the aspect of clinically nuanced cost sharing tied to participation was something we thought was going to lead to better results than just simply lowering cost sharing. And while you can't precisely, even though our co-author Betsy Cliff, grad student, has looked very, very hard to see the impact of the participation required independent of the cost-sharing reduction, we know compared to other VBID studies that the participation requirement was a very big deal. Here are some of the high-level findings, and many of you heard me say that my mother told me, I can't believe you had to get a $500,000 grant from SHADAC to show that if you make people pay less for something, they'll buy more of it. But in fact, when you asked Connecticut state employees to pay less for office visits compared to six other states, they want more often. The healthy people and the people with chronic diseases. When you asked people to pay less for lipid screening, for mammography, for important life-saving drugs, they bought them more often. Not a very, very large increase, a modest increase that hopefully will lead to, over time with populations, not only clinical improvements, but offsets in terms of total healthcare costs. And since many people in the room are interested, does a VBID plan with a participation requirement actually lead to significant changes in resource use in addition to clinical outcomes? You see here that at least at 2 years, which is a little bit too early to see the impact on many chronic diseases, there is a statistically significant trend in reduction in ER visits, as well as a very interesting finding that the state spent more money on both the preventive care and the chronic disease population, but the employees themselves, as you see on the right, spent less. And this makes this plan very, very popular. And at 2 years, 98% of the initial enrollees are still in the plan. So they like the idea of hopefully getting better health, but also saving money on their health care costs compared to relatives. So moving forward, I think that combining VBID principles with a participation requirement, which is often discussed in the consumer engagement community, is a good idea. Putting the participation on top of the lower cost sharing is good. Aligning clinically nuanced cost sharing with payment reform, in other words, getting that peanut butter of payment reform aligned with the jelly of consumer engagement will get us to the triple aim. And I think most of us need to understand that the current trend outside of these few examples is not to align consumers with provider payment reform. In fact, with the increase in high deductible health plans and other types of cost sharing, it's actually going in the wrong direction. So please increase my grad students' grade by following us on Twitter, @UM_VBID. The health affairs people took it off. And because, Alan, all of Betsy's hard work was combined into this really nice infographic, so 3,000 words into a very graphic display. It's available online for free and out at the front desk. Thank you very much.
Hello, everybody. What a real pleasure and honor it is to be a part of today's briefing. It's just great to hear the work that's being done to support consumers in decision making, as well as a lot of this research that's been is quite innovative and interesting. I want to acknowledge my co-authors, Judith Hibbard and Rebecca Sachs, as well as the JKTG Foundation for their support of this research. So our research examined consumer choice in making health plan decisions and insurance exchanges. The Affordable Care Act established the insurance exchanges to promote competition among health plans through presenting comparative information so consumers could make informed choices. Now, this is a really popular policy approach. However, consumer selecting of health insurance plans has been shown to be quite challenging. The terminology, particularly for health insurance terminology, is not widely known. Estimating one's costs in different plans based on projecting your health needs in the following year requires numeracy skills that most newly insured people don't have, and there is quite a bit of evidence to show that people are often selecting the cheapest health plan out there rather than really comparing costs and benefits. So starting the next benefit year, 2017, the exchanges will be presenting both cost information and quality information. And so the decision making may become a little bit more complicated. This benefit year, there are 6 state insurance exchanges of the 14 that are presenting quality information as well as cost. 5 of them use quality stars to indicate quality, where one state allows the states to put a narrative of their quality improvement strategies. I think this is a place where narrative might actually not be so good for consumers. Let's see if I can make this work. There's quite a bit of variation in how the current insurance exchanges are presenting quality. And so what I'm showing you here are screenshots from 3. You can see it's pretty far for you guys to see, but there are differences in terms of how many cost measures are shown alongside quality from 1 to 6. There are differences in whether the quality stars are next to the cost information or whether they're above, as in the display on the right. And they're also different in terms of how they're labeled. Some are labeled overall quality, some are labeled quality rating, and in several states didn't label the stars at all. So my colleagues and I have conducted research on presentation of comparative information to consumers in a number of other contexts, and we suspected that these differences probably had substantial impacts on how consumers would make sense of this information to make at least hypothetical decisions. So we sought to learn from the variation across these states' displays to see which approaches really supported consumers in considering quality as well as cost in making health insurance choices. We used an online experiment with over 1,000 subjects, adults between 18 and 64, using an online panel, and to match as well as we could the socioeconomic status of exchange enrollees, 40% had no more than a high school diploma. So what we showed them were five health plans, one of which we was sort of moderately priced but had the highest quality, and that's the one we considered our high value plan. We had a low cost, low quality plan, and then three others that sort of mixed it up. We varied the three aspects that I mentioned, the amount of cost information with either two or five indicators, the placement of the cost information, either before cost, after cost, or above cost. And we also varied the labeling. So we either called the stars quality rating, doctor rating, or star rating. And the key outcome was whether or not participants selected the high-value health plan. Respondents were randomized to one of 18 displays, which had all of these different combinations of displays. And the goal was to see how much difference did these presentations have on selecting the high-value health plan hypothetically, and whether this differed by numeracy level. And what we found is that presentation really mattered, as did numeracy skill. But interestingly, the presentation consistently influenced the choice of high-value health plan for both people with lower numeracy skills and higher numeracy skills. So if you look at the leftmost bars, those are about the amount of cost information, whether it was summarized, meaning only two indicators of cost, or detailed with the five indicators. And 60% of people selected the high-value plan when the information was summarized versus 46% when it was detailed. So it was a 14 percentage point difference. And what you see, the bars are based on numeracy tercile. And so the lower numerate participants always had lower selection of the high-value choices, but they were more likely to select the high-value plan when the information was summarized. We see that placement mattered. Really what mattered was when you didn't align the placement of quality with the cost, people were much less likely to consider quality in making their choice. And we didn't find that labeling mattered. Although we found an indirect relationship. When we labeled the stars doctor quality, people understood what the quality meant when we asked them in sort of a knowledge question. And that knowledge question was related to selecting a high value plan. Oops, that's not what I meant to do. So our key lessons were that how we present comparative information to consumers really matters. Every approach we use is nudging people one direction or the other. If we present five cost measures and one quality measure, we are nudging them to cost over quality. And we need to be increasingly aware of how we're presenting this information. And we're hoping that given the timing of this, that states who will be incorporating quality into their presentations for the next benefit year can take some of these very simple approaches to limiting the amount or trying to equate the amount of quality and cost information and placing the quality information alongside cost so that people can make more informed choices and think about quality when they're making choices too. Thank you. Good job.
All right, thanks so much for the opportunity to present our work. Jessica did a great job of setting up what I'm going to be presenting. I'd like to first acknowledge my co-authors who are listed there, all from the University of Pennsylvania, and also to the Robert Wood Foundation, who has supported this work for the last 3 years. So what we did in this study was to go shopping on the health insurance marketplaces, which included the 13 state-based marketplaces, as well as healthcare.gov, in this most recent open enrollment period that ended earlier this year. And what we were looking for were consumer decision tools that were available to help shoppers choose a plan. And when we compared what we found this open enrollment period to what we had found in the first two enrollment periods where we did a similar sort of shopping experience. So the first one I'd like to talk about, Jessica was just mentioning, are total cost estimators. These estimators allow consumers to enter additional information about their health and their healthcare use to produce a personalized out-of-pocket cost estimate that adds both the monthly premium to expected out-of-pocket costs like deductibles and co-pays and co-insurances. And the hope would be that these estimates help consumers understand the cost trade-offs and also hopefully minimize their surprise when they go to seek care and might have high out-of-pocket costs. And then based on her paper, also showing that they're actually choosing higher value plans potentially when they're shown these sorts of total cost estimates. What you can see in the blue columns is the number of sites in this most recent open enrollment period that had total cost estimators. There are two columns. One is called real shopping, which is what consumers could see after they create an account, and then window shopping, which is what they could see before they created an account. And the reason we looked at these two shopping contexts is because, similar to in prior open enrollment periods, we actually found that these two contexts were very different even when you're looking within the same state. So what you can see is that in this most recent enrollment period, two states, that would be California and Kentucky, on their real shopping site included total cost estimators. They also are the only two states that used the total cost estimate to order their plans in the default order, meaning that when you sign onto the site for the first time, the plans appear in the order of cheapest to more expensive estimated total out-of-pocket cost. This is in contrast to the majority of the other sites, which just listed them by premium amount. There were five sites that used a total cost estimator in the window shopping experience, and healthcare.gov was among those. And the total cost estimator on healthcare.gov got a lot of media coverage this year, but notably, it really was only present on the window shopping experience. And then when you compare the blue columns to the green columns, which show how many sites included these tools in the first and second, you can see that it's increased over time. However, when we took a closer look at the total cost estimators, we found an array of strategies that different states were using to generate and present these estimates. This is a screenshot from healthcare.gov, where they asked consumers one question to rank their utilization as low, medium, or high based on number of doctor's visits, the sort of lab tests they might need. And this is in contrast to, just as an example, Kentucky, where consumers were asked a long list of detailed questions about things like medical conditions. And so, you know, some of these made sense. It was like, are you planning to have a child this year? Some of them were, are you expecting to need treatment for an upset stomach? Which, as a clinician, I don't really know exactly how they would use that to make an estimate. And then also medications there on that sort of thing. And then it generated this list of estimated usage and the number of times you might use each of these things. And some of them, again, harder to estimate, like how many times you might think you need to use an ambulance or have an emergency transport. At this point, we don't know which of these strategies or the several others that we found produced the most accurate estimate or is most helpful to consumers. And validating the different support strategies will require collecting and making available new data. For example, marketplace web analytics linked to plan enrollment choices, and then ultimately also to claims data. The next tool I wanted to talk about were integrated provider lookups, which allow consumers to see if their preferred providers are in-network. And of course, this is important with the rise of narrow network plans. And in order to be counted, the provider lookup actually had to be on the exchange website itself. You couldn't have to link out to, for example, a Blue Cross Blue Shield website. And you can see that the majority of sites this year did include these, which was higher than in the first two open enrollment periods. And we also found for the first time that Colorado included an integrated drug lookup tool. And finally, we've highlighted since our work in the first open enrollment period, as Jessica mentioned, that a lot of people don't know what basic health insurance terms like deductible mean. And so we've been recommending a much simpler to implement consumer decision tool, which we call pop-up definition, so that when you're on the site and your cursor hovers over a term like deductible, an explanation appears that tells consumers in the moment that they're trying to make a decision what that means. And you can see again that this year, the majority of sites also included these pop-up definitions, higher than in the prior two. So while we found increased availability of consumer decision support tools in this third open enrollment period, more research is needed to determine what's actually helping consumers in the complex task of choosing a health insurance plan. And these data would allow marketplaces, as Jessica mentioned, to really focus their efforts on the strategies that are most effective and also help consumers avoid poor choices, which are not only costly to them, but also to the marketplaces and the taxpayers who are subsidizing the cost of the coverage. Thank you.
She was 1.5 minutes short. That is impressive. And I primary care doc, you have to
Unlike
finish
fast. Fendrick, who said he would be a minute and a half short. Sorry. You know, after people buy health insurance, they then end up in doctor's offices or other clinicians' offices. And for healthcare consumerism to work as it ought to work, when healthcare costs are relevant to decisions at hand, they should have productive conversations with their clinicians about those costs. I'm going to describe some barriers that get in the way of that happening. Healthcare consumers, there's an increasing emphasis in having patients pay some portion of their medical expenses out of pocket as they purchase an increasing number of insurance plans with high out-of-pocket costs. When people face high out-of-pocket costs, that means they ought to be coming to clinicians and trying to figure out how to factor that cost into the decisions they make. I'm going to look at what happens when doctors and patients talk about healthcare costs in healthcare clinics. And I'm doing this in collaboration with support from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and with collaboration from a company, Verilog, Inc., that does marketing research in clinicians' offices. With the permission of doctors and patients, audio records clinical interactions and gave me access to these de-identified transcripts of these encounters. And with my team, we looked at three groups of patients: breast cancer patients seeing oncologists, rheumatoid arthritis patients seeing rheumatologists, people with major depression seeing psychiatrists, all of whom are likely to face high out-of-pocket costs if they have the kind of insurance that requires them to pay. And this is part of this study, this is a qualitative analysis that looks at what physician behaviors stand in the way of helping patients navigate their out-of-pocket spending. And sadly, there are times where the doctor just didn't recognize that the patient had a potential financial concern. I know there's a new thing out there for the ulcer besides the Nexium, because that's so expensive. Expensive would be, we did use the methotrexate, said the doctor. Methotrexate is not a stomach pill, it's a rheumatoid arthritis pill. Basically, the doctor switched the conversation to another topic and never addressed the patient's concern about the expense of Nexium. And there are many cheaper alternatives to that. There are times where the patient brings up some kind of frustration with out-of-pocket costs and blames either the pharmaceutical company, say, or the insurance company for not covering it more, and then they have this great bonding experience over frustration with the system and never get back to the patient's cost concerns. What else would you need? The Restoril, folic acid? No, not the Restoril. They won't approve that one, the insurance company. I don't know why. Those insurance companies, they don't want to pay, I know, for anything. Bonding. I also need the Tylenol 3. The doctor moves on and, again, never gets back to the topic. There are transcripts that went pages long in this domain of bitterly complaining about the CEO salary at Aetna, for example, and never addressed the patient's concerns. It's funny, except it's not. There are times where the doctor dismisses the patient's financial concerns. We'll see if the insurance company is going to pay for your BRCA test, a genetic test, to look at risk for future breast cancers. How much does it cost if I have to pay for it, the patient has, this is a woman with breast cancer. Oh, we don't want to talk about that. Well, no, we do want to talk about that. There are times the patients, they're apologetic to even bring up the topic of cost a lot of times, and then sometimes they do it and try to dismiss it. We can't readily accept those dismissals. If they bring it up, it's hard enough to do that, we should dig down. Okay, and your insurance company had no problem paying for it, the doctor asks, so the doctor brings this up. Well, we paid, they paid. Well, there was a lot of copay, but that's okay, that's not a problem. Okay, says the doc. Well, no, I think if a patient mentioned there's a lot of copay, it might be time to find out if they're burdened by that. A fourth or third of Americans in the course of a given year will talk about having difficulty paying for some of their medical care. Even when physicians try to address financial concerns, those efforts can fall short. Sometimes they assume coverage means full coverage. There's lots of conversations we saw where they said, yeah, insurance should cover it. Well, knowing that it's covered doesn't mean you know what the patient's out-of-pocket expenses are, and clearly we need better tools to know what those cost, Anna, but a lot of times physicians are just assuming that if it's covered, then the patient's okay, but in fact, their out-of-pocket portion of that expense could be burdensome. Often there's an assumption that generic must mean affordable, and you see patients coming back to the clinic complaining how much they're paying for their generic medicines, and the physicians responding just in shock that generics would be expensive. Often when patients have very expensive medications and have high out-of-pocket costs, physicians will talk about getting them lined up with copay assistance programs and other such relief. But those are often short-lived, and not every patient qualifies for it. And so discussing it is a great start to resolving patients' out-of-pocket concerns. It might not be a good ending. More needs to be done. And then often you see, and copay assistance is one example of it, free samples is another, where they're taking this kind of Band-Aid under their short-term solving a problem that has really needs to be solved on a long-term basis. And there's no concrete evidence we saw in some of these interactions that people were really trying to come up with a long-term plan. And then really maddeningly, there are times where patients had very high costs for, say, very expensive narcotics for their cancer-related pain, and there was no discussion of low-cost long-acting narcotics. And so patients went away in pain and financially burdened when both could have been dealt with. Healthcare consumerism is undermined whenever clinical interactions lead patients, or physicians really, to miss opportunities to explore less costly alternatives for their patients and to identify means by which they can receive their current interventions at lower prices for a sustainable period of time. Thanks to my co-authors, and I'm going to be 30 seconds short. I'm not like you, but I'm better than Fendrick.
That's all that matters to me. That's all that matters.
Oops. Great, thank you. I want to thank Health Affairs for the opportunity to be here today, to be a part of this panel and this issue. I also want to thank Peter for setting up very nicely some of the issues and reasons why we think patients are interested in potentially shopping on price for their health care. And I think along with patients' own desires to know their costs of care as their own cost-sharing obligations increase, there's also a system perspective where we think that increasing price transparency can increase then the value that we get for our decisions in the healthcare system. And so these sophisticated price transparency tools have started to become increasingly available to insured consumers and patients over the last few years, and until now we haven't known who's using the tools and how they're being used. So in this study, I worked with Meredith Rosenthal to look at non-elderly adults who are insured on an Aetna health insurance plan and see who's using Aetna's price transparency tool and how it's being used. And I want to acknowledge funding from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation for this work. So when I say sophisticated price transparency tools, what does that mean? And what I mean is tools that provide meaningful price information to patients. And so the elements of that are that it's an estimate of a patient's own out-of-pocket cost and that it's at the episode level. And health plans, and Aetna's tool does this, are well-positioned to sort of present this information to consumers because they have information about the plan's own negotiated rates and the patient's own health plan benefit design and spending year-to-date in the plan. And so the idea is that the patient can go online. Here's a screenshot from Aetna's member payment estimator from 2012, which was the study, the period that I looked at, and could log in and select for one of over 500 bundles of services to get price estimates within a specified zip code. Now, you could go in and put in a specific provider's name and get an estimate for your out-of-pocket costs at that provider, or you could simply say, as in the case of this screenshot, I'm interested in an upper GI endoscopy, and I live in this zip code, and you'd get this result. And you can see really quickly that the column on the far right, it's hard to read, but what that is it's an estimate of your payment. So the only price that comes up on the front page is the out-of-pocket cost estimate. And that if you click through on the link underneath that, you go through to more detail about the total cost, the amount Aetna would pay, and what your responsibility is. But this really is a tool directed towards patient shopping based on their own expected costs. So we looked in the first 2 years that the tool was available to consumers, who used the tool and how was it used, and found that in 2011 and 2012, just over 332,000 enrollees used the tool, which is about 3.5% of those who had access. That a tool like this is really most useful to patients who are considering having one of the procedures or bundles of services that's on the price tool, or who are going to have it. If you're not expecting to use care, or if you're having some other kind of care, it's not that useful. So we looked among procedures that were most commonly searched, we looked at patients who had that procedure and then said, well, what characteristics of patients actually used the tool to shop versus those who didn't, and found among patients that younger patients, those who are healthier than other patients, and those who have higher annual deductible spending in the year were across the board more likely to price shop in advance of having their service. We also found interestingly, though, that a large portion of people searching for prices not only had no history of the service, as the slide says, so suggesting that there's some new information, but many, many did not actually go on to have the service in our time period. Now, it's possible they had it later. We looked over a two-year period, but still it suggests that there's a lot of information being delivered here, perhaps whether that's impacting people's decisions to have care or not. That would be an interesting question going forward. We looked at the most frequently searched services. Here's a shot of the top 10. There was a remarkable consistency over the first 2 years, and a lot of services fall into a couple big categories. So, for example, preventive screening services, colonoscopy and mammograms top the list, childbirth, some imaging services, and other select outpatient procedures. And this is the big takeaway. Sorry, I'm really going the wrong way on the arrows. Okay, there we go. I think that sort of highlights the first takeaway from this analysis, that in fact, price information on healthcare is most useful for patients when they can know it in advance. So for a planned service where they have time to incorporate the price information into their decision about whether to have care and where to go. And that those are the characteristics of the services that we see most frequently queried on this tool. And I collect these into a sort of a term of shoppable services. So we think there probably are a set of services that are more akin to this sort of price shopping. I also think that when you think about having a patient at the center of the healthcare system and having them be really engaged in their decision making about health and their healthcare, that tools like this one that provide price information, along with tools that provide quality information, are really important. This is an important first step to making patients engaged in their healthcare decision making. But that being said, the evidence from this study suggests that our efforts to engage patients with this information is very much still a work in progress. I think we're at the beginning of the road here, and thinking about innovative ways to engage patients for whom this information would be useful, to educate them that it's available and how they can use it, how they can bring it up in a conversation with their provider in a way that perhaps could help then influence their care, is important work going forward. Thank you.
Well, you thought the purpose of that panel was to discuss engagement on price and quality. It was actually a research project that demonstrates that when you capitate health services researchers at $0, they do tend to stint on time. Let me ask a couple of specific questions, and then one that sort of the last presentation left me with. But Mark, I just want to ask quickly, the focus of that of the work really was on this notion of, if you will, compelling engagement or strongly creating incentives for engagement in order to stay in the program. There's a lot of concern about penalizing, not just on clinical, emergency room availability, but the general topic of penalizing people for what might not be healthy behavior. So I just wonder if you can sort of put the program design in the context of that broader concern.
I just want to say, having written about
increasing cost sharing for low-value services in 2011 in health affairs. Thankfully, we were really blessed by the creation of Choosing Wisely 6 months later, which gave us kind of a national conversation about the fact that more isn't always better. And I think that as you see the same time quality gaps and fiscal pressures, the only way that you could really achieve short-term and substantial savings, given that most of the things we recommend to patients don't lower healthcare costs, is that we have to ultimately balance encouraging the things that make individuals and populations healthier, and also understand that some people estimate up to a third of our $3+ trillion goes to things that don't make folks healthier at all. If I may, since I'm gonna act fee for service, I just wanna say a couple things about the transparency movement. One is, just because you know the price doesn't mean that you need it. And I think that since this PCORI, I'm speaking, so much of this discussion around transparency is suggesting that you shop around for things. If you don't need them, even if they're low cost, you shouldn't buy them, although many members of my family do that. And I think the other two things very quickly, Alan, is I love these consumer price tools, but consumer prices in millions of Americans in high deductible plans actually change from January to December. And this idea of providing a tool that's static as opposed to dynamic is something that may actually cause more problems. In the last, that amazing presentation, I found it striking, as this will be my final point, is that the ACA VBID part of the law makes up to 80 high-value preventive services at zero cost sharing. I was stunned to see that the top two measures included in the last presentation are services that have zero cost sharing. So the fact that HHS reports that 137 million people have access to zero cost sharing services, but only 75,000 has accessed them, suggests that these experts to my right should maybe just do a better job communicating the fact that why the heck are you looking for the price of the mammogram? Because if you knew what your coverage was, you would be getting it for nothing. Thank you. Amen.
Clarify.
I just wanted to clarify, if that's okay, the two things. One is that the price tool that we evaluated does account for deductible spending year to date, sort of addressing that criticism. I agree with the point that as you spend money in your health plan over the year, your out-of-pocket costs change, you know, depending on when you then have your next service. And the Aetna tool does, because it uses their real-time claims adjudication system, does account for that in the price estimates.
Right, so people are getting the right information, but I don't think it changes the point that maybe they don't need it, even though it's correct.
But they find out their colonoscopy is free.
I think that's
which
right.
Which is worth a lot.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. I think in an ideal situation, people would know when they choose their plan what benefits are covered at zero cost, and I think the fact that this evidence, one of the ways I interpret that is that that's actually not well known, and that people are going in to learn about benefit design and what's free and what's not free as much as any comparison shopping across providers.
So this now growing discussion around changing price over the time of the year, it also, Charlene, it always makes me wonder when I see these sort of aggregators that not just on the dollar side, but what people need is not stable. And so I was interested, you showed these two examples, one of sort of, I expect to be high, medium, low, and you sort of think, well, what is that? But then the checklist of whether you're gonna need an ambulance, I'd love to know how people answer that one. So how I was just wondering about whether some thought seems to have been given to stability of use and whether it's really a good idea for people to use their historical utilization to predict the future. In some areas, it seems like that would make sense. In others, it wouldn't.
Yeah, I've seen a presentation on this at the Academy Health Research Meeting last year, which actually showed that people are pretty poor at predicting what their utilization is going to be. And, you know, the point of our study was really just to see what's available now. And like I said, you know, even some of the conditions that you're allowed to choose, and some sites you were allowed to choose multiple conditions, and other sites they had a concrete list that actually had some combinations of things, but you could only choose one. So, for example, you could choose diabetes and rheumatoid arthritis, or diabetes and inflammatory bowel disease. But if your combination of diseases didn't exist in that list, like, you had no other option. And then some of the other things that they listed, like manic depression was one of the conditions that they listed, but they didn't list some other common, you know. The point was that we need more research and we need to figure out what people are doing and where they're getting their platforms and the evidence for how effective they are.
Okay, so I want to ask sort of the big question that, Jessica, you sort of sotto voce at the very beginning said, you know, maybe more narrative isn't such a good thing. And then you went on with your presentation, kind of like what Peter describes that physicians do when people bring up price. And then Peter and Anna, both of you got into this whole sort of how do we talk about this topic? And I was left with this sort of challenge, which is for all of the problems around price transparency, at the end of the day, price is unidimensional. There is a number, and quality is anything but unidimensional. It's not only multidimensional, but it's also very subjective in terms of what people think is important as they think about quality. And so as I listen to presentation after presentation and this notion of communicating, engaging on price and quality, and the relative emphasis we want people to give, which should really be up to them, how do we combine a unidimensional measure or metric with which we want to be clear to people with this multidimensional that if we make it too multidimensional, it's opaque and people can't use it, but if we scale it down to the single dimension like a couple of stars, it leaves out so much signal you're just left with noise. So this is my last question of the day, and then we'll see if there's some from the audience, but help us as we think about this enterprise going forward, how do we deal with the very different notions of price and quality as important, but really fundamentally different constructs when we're talking to patients or people trying to be consumers? Who's gonna solve this problem for us?
I won't solve the problem, but I will say I think it's actually more complicated than what you said, because I don't think, at least in the context of health insurance, price isn't unidimensional, so there are, it's how many indicators of price do you put there, and then we're trying to move to a unidimensional version of it with what you were describing, where they have these estimated total costs, but the question is how close are those really? And I will just say that my offhand comment about narrative might be not being so effective in this context, I probably didn't give enough context, which is that a number of health plans were putting like several paragraph descriptions of their quality improvement strategies. And I just could tell you there's no way that consumers are thinking, well, that sounds really interesting, what's there in that last, you know, 10th paragraph there, and therefore I'm going to choose this plan.
Well, I'll throw another monkey wrench in, then a dash of hope, then I'll mix a metaphor. So one monkey wrench is that actually people take price as a signal of quality, and I've just started doing research on this, and it's a very interesting, complicated ways they interpret it. So it's messier than we even think. But I think the dash of hope would be, you know, look at what Consumer Reports does. They show you the price of the products, but then you have all those little circles, different colors, how much are shaded in, and you know, you get a pretty good sense. And it's not perfect, and we'll do research to see what works better and what works worse, but is that, I mean, it's better than not having that information. And so I think we're moving, we can't let, you know, perfection be the enemy of et cetera.
That's the mixed metaphor.
And I'll just add, some of this work started with a qualitative study we did when we watched young adults who were actually shopping for health insurance on healthcare.gov. And I think one, it's even a little bit more complicated because quality, when you're thinking about which health plan might be best for you and your family, is going to be different for each person. And what they found to be the most helpful was just to get assistance from someone who knew more than they did. So working with navigators, working with their parents to help them weigh these different trade-offs between the costs, between the specific medical conditions they have and that they expected to need care for.
Yeah, I agree very much with what Charlene was just saying, and I think that one of the things I think would be really interesting is to think about how patients can take these tools and get over the impasse of bringing them into the clinician's office with them and as another potential navigator, another expert who can weigh in and help with decision making, because I agree completely that it's complicated and that price and quality need to be together in the decision.
So, Ellen, Peter and I agreed to disagree on this panel, and this is easy for me in the fact that the evidence on shopping is unbelievably disappointing and frustrating to think that if we make them better, make them tools, I'm somewhat pessimistic in this regard, and given all the options, I'm channeled not by health services researchers, but by Yogi Berra, who said, if there's a fork in the road, take it. And I'll say this to you, but more importantly to Joe, that if we somehow were to change this system to pay providers and incent consumers
on services for which evidence suggests that individuals and population health improve, we would have to worry so much less about this. I do not want my colleagues nor my patients shopping for care when they don't know whether they need it or not. And I think that the movement afoot to study what patients want and understand their preferences, and once you know them, to make it easier to make those decisions as opposed to harder, which I believe is what I've heard on this panel, I'm somewhat pessimistic about this process. I don't want this put in the patient's hands. I just think it's way too complicated.
I think VBID does try to put it in patients' hands. I think it does. I think if you align prices with value and people shop, I think that is the win-win.
Okay. Oh. I think Joe has a... Joe,
I called him out twice, so he figured he asked him.
So since I'm way up front, Joe Selby from PCORI and Austin. For 5 minutes of airtime.
Fame. It's fame.
Really incredible. But you made it a wonderful day. And I also, this last panel, which was very concerned about costs and particularly out-of-pocket costs, I thank you. You none of you mentioned PCORI even once, and I know you did it out of care and concern, but you might have gone a little too far. We've been on record from the very beginning as saying that out-of-pocket costs are an important item to study in a patient-centered research agenda because, as you know better than I, costs matter a lot in decision-making. So don't forget that. I hope we see some applications coming from every presenter that presented today. Thanks again.
Great. Good. Good. Let's get two, and then I promise we'll wrap up from a long day. But thank you, Joe.
Hi, Casey Quinlan. I'm here, I think, representing the patient voice, although I wear a lot of hats. I want to ask you guys and everybody in the room when it will be possible for the actual people on the ground like me who are gaslighted every time I try to get cost information from my insurer, which begins with an A, but is not Aetna. You can do your own math. But they gaslight me every time, even though with the cost thing they have on their site, but I go there and it doesn't really tell me anything, and then I have exchanges with the help people, and then finally they tell me, oh, well, we can't tell you that until the claim is submitted because that's proprietary business information. So I think that patients could be a lot more help than we are being asked to be on this so far. So I just ask you to include us in designing some of the programs and research that you guys are building, because I think we could maybe hurry things up a little bit.
Great. I don't think you'd find a researcher who disagrees with the challenge associated with how we do things now, the way that it limits consumer engagement in a serious way, and the opportunity that would be opened up if we had that. So I appreciate the comment, but I don't see anyone up here primed to disagree. I'm just going to do one last one because I know we're coming up on 1 o'clock and you all have been very patient.
Thank you very much, Holly Whitteman. I had a question to Dr. Fendrick about the participatory requirement. And you listed a couple of examples of what some of those things might be. And some of those things are within an individual's control and others are not. And so I'm wondering about the ethics of making people pay more because they're unable to achieve, say, a certain level of hemoglobin A1C. Even though they're doing all the right things, but it may not be working out for them.
No, I'm going to look at the infographic to see where actually I made that point. So they had to basically complete the care. So I apologize if I misspoke.
Okay.
As we deal with consumer advocates and as we look at various types of programs, we do not want to put things on the consumer that is out of their control.
Okay.
In fact, most of our work is about following the services. And for instance, there's a lot of people who just don't get better following evidence-based services, and there are protocols that exist that are not VBID-esque that have those, like, you should not need a biologic for rheumatoid arthritis, but we know that a lot of people who take generic drugs need a biologic, and they're actually penalized by their biology and the economics moving that forward. So we try very hard, having heard from lots of consumers, and this was a collectively bargained type of health plan, that we never put an onus on a consumer that they were not directly in charge in. We argue strongly for that in our programs moving forward.
All right, thank you.
Well, I want to close by again thanking PCORI for their support. Remind you that we will shortly be announced. That date can't quite be right. So, anyway.
going on a time machine. We're going on a time machine.
Yeah, there
this
we go.
Great, Alan. Thank
you. But keep your eyes open for our event on the future of value-based payment in May. And thanks to all of you for your participation. You're sticking with us, and please join me in thanking our final panel.
You guys are great. You guys are great.